smells nice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
For some reason, we can do it after for the 1 minute, and I don't know why. Whatever you want.
You mean to, just to ask if that would be added at the beginning? We're not even going to add it at the beginning.
Right, we're not going to go through all the bits and
pieces. Should I just leave that one or all?
Let's do it. No. I'm definitely not.
Come to the right.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to begin tonight's meeting, called to order this city council meeting, Monday, May the 4th, 2015, at 7:03 p.m. Clerk Treasurer Charlotte Derrick, would you please call the roll?
S.E. Brown.
Here.
Lee Johnson.
Here.
Rod Powell.
Here.
Trey Burgess is absent. Tim Terry.
Here.
Lance Terry.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Is Pastor Zerbel here by chance? I missed him. Didn't make it tonight. If you would please stand with us, and we'll have our prayer and pledge of prayer led by Richard McKinney and Pledge of Allegiance by Chief Will Dawson.
Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening here. We thank you for the opportunity to be living in a nation as great as this. We pray, Lord, for the leaders at our national level, state, and our local level, that you always be with them as they seek your guidance as they make decisions. We thank you, Lord, for this community and for the influence it has in this area. We thank you especially for this governing body that is represented here tonight. We especially want to take time and pray for Trey Burgess and the Burgess family as he undergoes this very, very difficult time. We pray that everything that is said and done here this evening will be cordial and acceptable and pleasing to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, and you may be seated. I'd like to ask the council for approval of our minutes for the April 6, 2015 council meeting.
I'll make a motion we approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve minutes.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
Yes.
Mr. Terry?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Thank you. At this time, I think I need to go out of order just a little bit, as I normally do, but I need to get something taken care of and add the bid opening to the agenda and put that up at the top if we possibly could, if the council would be okay with that.
Sure. I'm okay.
Great. Okay. Yeah, we're just going to add it to at the beginning, so we'll do it after the recognition. Okay, thank you. So, we're moving into something that's hugely important, as all things are here at City Hall. But this is pretty big. If you've noticed, we've got a crowd here tonight, and we welcome our crowd, this side of the room is really pretty. Half of this side of the room is really pretty. I'm not sure about the guys back there in the back, but ladies, basketball team's here tonight, and we thank you for being here. And by the way, you have to stay for the whole thing. You can't just show up and leave. No, we've had one pastor come and pray and stay for the whole thing, and he never has come back. So that's the reason we have to do this ourselves. But we've got a very special recognition tonight. And I will step forward, and I also would like, did our press get back? There he is. Okay. I'm going to step forward to read this, if that's okay. Normally, the voice of the bulldog is to do most of this stuff. We'll have him come up in just a second. I certainly want to have a picture made. Let me read this to you real quick. This is a proclamation being known to all to whom these presents come in the city of Greenwood, Arkansas, by and through the Honorable Mayor Doug Kinslow, bestows a special recognition upon Coach Clay Reeves. Whereas Coach Reeves and the Greenwood High School basketball team have won their fourth state championship, and whereas Coach Reeves is the only girls coach in Arkansas history with seven state titles, and whereas our city is proud of 71% winning percentage, that's 252 wins, 99 losses here in Greenwood that Coach Reeves has earned, and the fine publicity he has brought to our community. And whereas the team's accomplishments are consistent with head coach Reeves' dedication to academic excellence, personal growth, and unity. Now, therefore, I, Doug Kinslow, Mayor of Greenwood, congratulates Coach Reeves, Greenwood High School, its basketball team, and the athletic department for its outstanding accomplishments. Given under my hand and affixed with the seal of the great city of Greenwood, Arkansas, this fourth day of May 2015, signed by myself and our city clerk treasurer, Charlotte Derrick. Coach, if you'll come up, and we'll do a picture of the coach and I, if that's okay. And then we'll get the ladies that make this possible. Thank you, ladies.
Hey, Mayor, please.
Yes, sir. I don't mind holding your flag. Everybody surround him there and get your picture made. I'd get behind you. You guys are tall, too. Ladies, no, you're fine. You're fine. I was going to stand up. Voice of the Bulldogs.
No, no.
So did I say Razorbacks earlier?
No, you didn't say Bulldogs.
No, seriously.
I don't need any.
Oh, you do. Come on. Everybody say Tim.
No.
Tim.
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 Tim. Tim. We want you to squat. Thank you, Coach.
Wow, she really should.
They took me at my word. Thank you, folks, for coming. Parents, thank you guys. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Oh, there's scouts back there. Cool. I got it.
You can move to the front now. No.
Troop 54. Yes.
1989.
Welcome. You guys here just to listen and learn. Hope you're not going to make notes or anything. Appreciate y'all being here. Taking mental notes? Okay. Oh, I see you back there now. I'm sorry. I didn't see you. Okay. Where am I? Did you want to?
Sure, yeah.
Charlotte Derry has something she'd like to talk to you about real quick.
Visibly. Yes, I just would like the council to acknowledge that this happened. We held the first ever in Greenwood Arkansas City Clerks Recorders Treasurers Association District Workshop right here in Greenwood. Mansfield and Greenwood partnered together, and their city clerk and I held this workshop. It's overseen by the University of Arkansas Municipal Clerks Institute, and we had attendance about 33 other clerks, treasurers, and recorders from the same different cities in Arkansas. And we had a tour of both cities on Thursday, and Mansfield's mayor and our mayor, guided the tours on the school. Many thanks to our school for donating a bus and a driver to drive us around. And then we ate dinner at Maggio's afterwards, and the next day was a full day of learning held at Farmers Bank Community Room, and I believe it was a big success. We had a lot of speakers, some preparing for an audit, municipal accounting. June Barron, the deputy legislative auditor for the state of Arkansas, came down and talked to us. the Department of Labor came down and talked to us, and it was just a really good deal, and I was just proud that we could host that for the first time in Greenwood, because I'm always going to the other cities, and so I just think it was cool, and I would just like you to know about it.
Thank you, Charlo. And I was able to do the bus, the driver, I'll tell you real quick, the driver drove according to the way I spoke, so he would speed up and slow down, and it was kind of hard on him, but we had a good time. And I think you mentioned Judge Hudson was here.
Oh, Judge Hudson, yes.
Came and also welcome everybody.
Yes, definitely.
And today, we just keep getting bigger and bigger. Today we had a group of mayors here, not near the turnout we thought we were going to have, but Mayor Sanders was here from Fort Smith, Mayor Lawrence from Huntington, Mayor Austin. From Mansfield, and I apologize, Bradford, I believe, is the gentleman's name from Hartford that was here. I'm not positive on that name, but anyway, had some mayors here to put some folks on a committee. So, and normally that's done in Fort Smith, and Mayor Sanders called a few weeks ago and wanted to know if we would be willing to host that here. So things keep coming down here, and it's kind of neat to have people come down and be a part of our city instead of everybody going to Fort Smith all the time. So, good stuff. We did have a couple of department heads come in and try to sneak a sandwich out of what we were eating too, but that's beside the point. We won't mention any names, Chief Brian and Sonny Bill. I believe that's all the recognitions and knowledge we have. We'll move right into the committee reports. Kenny Sunday.
We have a bid opening.
Oh, I'm sorry. I
yes,
did this
hard.
While ago. I'm going to put the bid opening there. Thank you. Yeah, Michael, if you'll come up. Sorry.
Mayor, Council, Mr. Hamby, we're opening bids tonight for the Bell Park Amphitheater. This is the section of seating that goes up above the stage area. And the amphitheater, if you guys are familiar with the site. You guys have a bid tabulation sheet there that I passed out earlier, and I'm just going to read them out in the order that they're on this. This will be the order that they picked up plans in our office. Actually, thank LJB did not turn in a bid, so just strike them off. First one, I'll read the Shears Construction. Shears Construction, their contractor's license number is 00399-20815. They do have a 5% bid bond present. Their base proposal price is $245,195, 245,195. There are three deductive alternates. Omit ramps on the north side, $23,085. 23085. Omit ramps on the south side, same amount, 23085. And omit decorative concrete finish, 8610, $8,610. They do acknowledge receipt of addendum number one, and Bashir's construction is listed as the concrete contractor that will be self-performing that work, and it's the same license number. Second bid is, I'm going to say turnkey, and apparently they did not turn in a bid either, so our next bid is Crawford Construction. Crawford Construction's license number is 00124-10216. They do have a 5% bid bond present. Their base bid is $246,100, 246100. The deductive alternates, omit the north ramp, 37,000. $414.97. Omit the south ramp, $36,288.97. And omit the decorative concrete finish, $13,887.22. And they do acknowledge receipt of addendum one. Crawford Construction is listed as the concrete subcontractor, so it's the same license number. That is Steve Beam. They do have a 5% bid bond present. The contractor's license number is 00661010015. Their base proposal price is $177,600, 177,600. Out of deductive alternate one, omit north ramp, 16,000. Omit south ramp, 16,000. And omit decorative concrete is 8,300. They do acknowledge receipt of addendum number one. Next bid is Circle M Construction. Their contractor's license number is 01358004016. They do have a 5% bid bond present. Their base proposal price is $251,964, 251964. The deductive alternates, the north ramp is $23,896. South ramp, same price, $23,896. And omit decorative concrete finish, $8,300. They also do acknowledge receipt of addendum number one. So it looks like this time Steve Beam Construction is the apparent low bidder, but we'll take the bids under advisement and collaborate with Parks Department and see where we want to go from this point forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. And from what I can understand, all construction will be hid from all brides. Good luck with that.
We need to make a motion to accept the lowest bidder.
I think we normally do, right?
I'll make a motion to accept the lowest bidder.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
Yes.
Vice Terry?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, now we will move into committee reports. Yes. Kenny Sunday is not here this evening. We have anybody from Boys and Girls Club? SRCA, I know Lisa did not make it. She turned in a report. Did we get a copy of that to everyone?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, you have a copy of that? I'd like to be able to answer any questions, but I can't, so. If you have questions, please get back with Brooke or I, and we can relay those on to Lisa if you have any. Parks Commission, I know Mr. Goldstein's not here, but Richard McKinney is going to report for the Parks Commission tonight.
Councilman Sterrett, there are several projects around going right now. Parks Department is extremely busy at the moment. Eagle Scout Park is undergoing a renovation. It's an Eagle Scout project coming in, and we are replacing all the damaged swings that are out there, planting new trees, planting some shrubs, installing two benches. They cleaned out that back thicket, fence and everything torn out between Eagle Scout Park and Denver Street Baptist, and you can actually see the playground from Denver Street now, which is kind of shocking to see that. And they're getting ready, this Saturday, we'll install a wood rail fence there. That's all been taken care of by one of the Eagle Scouts. We have an East Lab sponsored bike-a-thon scheduled for this Saturday. One of the East Lab students decided to take this on as her school project for this year and wanted to draw attention to the trails. So she is starting at noon down here at City Hall, will ride up to Bell Park, a bunch of cyclists, and then turn around and come back down here. We helped sponsor that and bought them some t-shirts for their first 20 entrants. Amphitheater groundbreaking, we hope to have on the 17th of this month at the fundraiser event at Bell Park. Clock tower renovation has been complete. We had our engineer come out here, and I've got the report, received it this morning. The tower is repairable. I know that'll be good news to a lot of folks. That was definitely a concern at one point. I've got more details, but basically it'll involve some epoxy injection up at the top of the tower to bond all the loose pieces together and stop the rust. And then he said the wood beam structure that supports the bell needs to be removed and replaced immediately. That is not a good, and we got photos that we saw back in 2007, and then they don't look any better today. So we're gonna try to get on that fairly quickly. And we'll probably come in with some funding requests with that to help Parks Department out on that as we go. We're working with the mayor's office to resolve the Hartzell Creek creek straightening project that we had in 2007, 2008. There was an issue, and we started pursuing our Crooked Creek Park, and we wanted to cross through Hartzell Creek in a path to come up and connect to the main trail artery. Corps of Engineers stepped in and said, not until you finish what you started in 2007. So we went back in, and we've hired, or the city has hired Rixie Engineering to come in and write up a proposal, what they think that would make the Corps of Engineers happy. And they are evaluating that now to see if we can get that resolved. As soon as that is resolved, we'll pursue the Crooked Creek Community Park and trail connected to that. We've received permission from Arkansas Valley Electric Cooperative to utilize their easement on the backside of the Mountain Bell Park. As you go up over Main Street where the sidewalk stopped, up there by Dr. Johnson's house, we'd like to continue that over the top of the hill and then make a left and go back down their power line and then connect back up to the trail again. That'll add some more mileage to the walking trail and another loop. Kind of come right back up in behind the Valley, Valley Loop community, and eventually we'll be able to tie into there. The grant applications that you guys had your special call meeting for last month, I appreciate that. Those were hand-delivered down to Arkansas Highway Department. Had plenty of time, those have been received. Those are 80-20 grants, and we were gonna be pursuing the trail out at the City Lake. Extended that. We went ahead and applied for about $150,000. We can still use, still an 80-20, and we have $20,000 budgeted for that this year for our 80-20 part. Pavilion alarm, camera, and access control system is in its final stages. We're working out the bugs on that now. This allows Brooke to, as people are renting the pavilion, they'll receive a PIN number that is activated for the time of their rental. They can go up there and punch in. And we don't have to sit there and issue keys and chase keys down. And that also gives us camera coverage of the area, so we can kind of watch your building a little bit better. Veterans Memorial website is complete. We just had some training on that earlier in the week. This will allow visitors to come into the city, get on the website, and they can click. And this was Ms. Kimberly Brown's idea to come up with this. You'll be able to locate any veteran by, just by typing in the name. And it'll pinpoint where in the park that stone is at, and then you'll click on that stone, and a photo will pop up, a small bio, tell you everything about that veteran. So it should be a great enhancement for that park. Eagle Scout project is ready to go at the Greenwood Lake. That'll be installing two new trail, a new trail, and then two new benches out at City Lake. That'll be right down at the water's edge, just before you get to the old Iron Bridge that we placed there. Winford Park. The caboose now has water and power. We actually put a breaker panel inside the caboose, so if we decide we ever want to turn that into an office or a visitor center or something like that, we now have that wired up for that. Water is on site, ready to go. We'll start taking care of that. It looks a little bit rough right now. Now that we have the power hooked up, we'll get in there and grind the rest of those metal windows off, get that power washed, get the paint, put it back in red, and then we'll try to come up with some money to get some glass and put in that. That's our biggest activity is going. Have any questions? Yes, sir.
On that bell tower, clock tower?
Yes, sir.
My feelings on that are, I know y'all are struggling within the parks to identify money to fix it properly. That's an icon of the city of Greenwood, and I think the city of Greenwood needs to, we'll help. I'll try to, whatever it takes to fix it right. Let's fix it right and be done with it.
We have $26,500 budgeted for that, and that's going to cover it, as I reported earlier, the clock mechanism, to put that all electronic and make that a functional clock that'll always be right on time. It's about $22,000. And then we factored in a little bit extra there to put the roof on. And Charles Eifert has said he would like to contact the school shop up there and see if they would like to fabricate the roof section for us. That's something that looks like it would be very doable and save us quite a bit of money. So we may have to come back and ask for a little bit extra.
You're probably going to have some kind of crane or something to.
Yes. Unfortunately, because of all the construction that went on with all the stones, it's probably going to take 100 ton of crane. Sitting out in front of AC's office to reach across to the jib out just so they can reach that.
You're talking about a $6,000 crane job.
We actually talked to one, for one day, it'd be about $2,200.
Okay.
We talked to one of our local crane companies and said they would help us out on that.
Well, that's probably discounted then.
Yes. Yeah, everybody wants to see that clock working again, so, and hear it. And the $22,000 from that company up in Minnesota, that was to include making the bell work. I mean, it all functions like it used to.
Well, what about just the tower repair?
Well, that's what we still need to have. We've got the engineering report. We'll turn that over to a couple of companies and let them look at it and see what it's going to cost to fix it up. We had approached one of the contractors that had done most of the work in the square, and they were reluctant to do anything with those wood beams until we had that tower evaluated. Now that it's been done, they may be able to come in here and help us out. And we'd like to have a new cross member already in place and ready to go, so when we take the old wood one out, set it down, disconnect the bell, hook the new one right back on it, while we have the crane there for one day, do all that part in one day, and just get one moving, and then do the roof structure probably after that. It's all fixable.
Your report, in your report, you said we had a special call meeting. Was I not there? Did I not know about that?
We didn't.
I just thought, well.
Yeah, you were gone.
Okay, so.
Minutes. Did we do minutes?
Yeah, I don't think I had minutes for it. I guess I even had a recording. Okay, well, I'll get those done and we'll just have the next meeting. If I have a recording, surely I do.
Well, for the concrete or the epoxy repair, I mean, that'll need that same crane, won't it, or will that be?
Don't know. We'll have to talk to the construction company. They may have their own. We brought in a towable man lift for the engineer, and we're able to get it back up over those curbs and get him up to the top of that, and that may be the way they'll want to go with that injection also. Those companies that do that for a living, they've got quite a bit of equipment. We'll let them figure out how to navigate it and work that into their price. But we can jump some dunnage up around and protect all the stones.
But that company knows what we have under it.
Pardon?
They know what we have under it. They've seen it.
Yes, that's correct. Cool. Any other questions?
What are you doing in your spare time? Thank you, Richard. And I echo what Councilman Powell said as far as helping getting this thing done. I mean, that's huge. And I know when I was parks director, that was probably one of the most frequently asked questions. When are we going to fix the clock? When are we going to get the bell ringing? And the wire hanging down is not an ideal situation, especially now that we know the timbers are rotten. So it's a good, a lot of good projects. Appreciate your hard work, Richard. Gary Grimes Consulting.
I didn't have anything but the questions. I think we're going to meet after
the study
session. So questions about anything right now, glad to answer. I think we're going to meet after.
Okay, thank you. Michael, you have a report on the police station.
Thank you, Council, Ms. Derrick, Mr. Hamby. Just wanted to give you guys a quick update on the police department project. We actually have a regular scheduled owner meeting tomorrow morning. But in our last meeting 2 weeks ago, the contractor reported to us that he thought he was 6 weeks behind schedule. He's not given me an updated actual paper schedule yet, but he should be doing that with his pay application, which he'll turn in the next couple days. So I'll have a time frame then. You guys are well aware, we've lost quite a few days during the winter weather, and with the little storm delay, claimed that he was going to make up time. But right now, I think he's wanting to be realistic with you guys as we're kind of nearing the completion date time, that he is feeling that, you know, he's going to try to make up as much time as he can, but realistically, he's about 6 weeks behind. We've got pretty much the same base we were last time. The contractor is going to be billed up to about $1.4 million. In this, leaving you a balance of about $852,000 for the remaining portion. The police have, with the change orders and the things we added for security, AV, training room equipment, the computer equipment and everything, they have remaining in their budget about $28,000 left in contingency. And then in addition to that contingency line item, we do have a group of allowances listed at up the bottom that add up to $23,850. So remaining in the project, total scope, we've got around $50,000 left outside of the contract amount if there anything arises from that point. But I think at this point, you know, I don't really see any major unforeseens happening. Like we mentioned last time, right now we don't have any pending change order items coming up. So as far as going, and really the biggest thing to report is the schedule impact. So just wanted to make you guys aware of that as we move forward. We're scheduled to be finished July 20th, so that's going to probably push us into August. And then when they turn in their pay application, I'm going to ask them for a plan of action to make up this time that they've lost and see what they can come up with here at the end.
I think their delay is completely understandable because that's area-wide.
Yeah.
Everybody in our area has been affected like that.
Yeah, we've got several projects going right now that
have been affected like that over at the school.
So yes.
It's just the timing of the storms that come through, and it's very understandable.
Right. Have anything else? Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Water and Wastewater Commission, Mr. Rattery.
Mayor, Council, Wastewater Commission met April 27th. We've got a couple of things going on. The major project that we're working on is related to the storage tank. You know, we've got two storage tanks we're trying to get in front of the council and make a decision on. One of those is going to be up off of Bell Road behind the golf course, and the other one's at the main plant. The one up at the top of the hill off of Bell Road is going to be 200,000 gallons, and then the one at the main storage water treatment plant is going to be 1 million gallons. I had a handout. My partner in crime left the building, so when he comes back in, we'll talk about that. But basically what we did was turn it over to John Bailey to work through the options of financing. One of those is with Stevens Inc. The second one was with Regions Bank.
He's back.
He shows up. He's late.
Oops. Hey, Steve, before you go, you said you meant behind Bellwood off of Oak or Hickory. You said Bell Road.
Bell Edition. I'm sorry. I did say Bell Road. It's Bell Edition up behind the golf course up on the ridge. We've got a tank up there.
I think that's
Bellwood.
I apologize for that. Are we clear now?
Yes, sir. I thought so, but for the record, I wanted to make sure.
So, John Bailey was responsible for looking at Stevens Inc. and looking at Regions, and you've got a summary that he wrote up. What it boils down to is Regions looks like our best option. Their upfront fees, mostly attorney fees, are a little on the high side, but that was the highest, the maximum that it would be. Those bond attorneys, he said, would probably come in a little less than that. But so it looks like Regions is going to be the best option for us to go with. If you look at the second page, it talks about the actual storage tanks. The 200,000 gallon tank that we're going to be putting up behind the golf course is going to be steel. It's going to be an elevated tank. It's pretty straightforward, and it's got the cost associated with that. That's the top tier. And then we're looking at the million-gallon tank, the possibility of putting concrete tank up there. And we've got those guys coming in on the 18th, which is our next meeting. We're meeting a week earlier due to the holiday in May. So if you want to come and hear that presentation, they're going to talk about the concrete tank. That may save us a little bit of money, not significant, but it will save us. Where the savings comes in is in the maintenance, the ongoing maintenance and support of that tank. We don't have to take it offline, go and strip it and paint it. It's pretty much, once it's there, it's there. So we'll keep you posted on how those kind of play out. I'm hoping to get in front of you with bond attorneys and an ordinance in July to move forward with a bond. It's probably going to be around $2-2.5 million project cost. We still have to evaluate the current bond that's maturing in 2022. We're paying about 3.75% on that. And this current bond that we'd be looking at is about 2.75. So we could save a percent if we refinance that bond. So that's our next step, is to evaluate the benefit of refinancing the bond or currently pay the bond out that we have, just continue paying on it. We have two bonds and two payments. So we'll keep you posted on that. But the 18th, we'll be discussing that a little bit more in detail. If you have any questions, we'll be glad to answer that. The fluoride tank is a little bit delayed. It's not behind schedule. We're still working on the equipment. They have until July 16th to complete that project. And then we can start holding them accountable contractually. So June 16th or July? June 16th, that was my bet. June 16th. So we're just waiting for them to all that stuff had to be special made per specification. So as soon as it gets here, it won't take too long to get it installed. The building itself is there, the pad's there. It's just getting the equipment in there and getting it up and running. Meadowbrook lift station tear out. Hopefully we'll start in June. We might start a little earlier. We're trying to play with the weather a little bit, get away from that so that we don't have weather delays. So hopefully it'll fall right into starting in June, and we'll get that lift station offline. As far as water is concerned, I think the mayor's going to add, or I may add, the mayor, if we decide on who's going to hit that, to the agenda for you guys to look at the letter of intent between the city of Greenwood and Simon Cree. The commission, as it wastewater commission, has already looked at it. We're good with it. I think Mr. Hamby wanted the council to evaluate that, so that's going to get added to the agenda. The only thing I wanted to cover additionally was we're in discussions through Mr. Hamby's office over an issue related to a gentleman on Weaver Street that wanted to tie in the sewer. He was remodeling the house. It's on septic system. He wanted to tie in the sewer. There was some back and forth discussions. Ultimately, he paid a tap fee, and we did allow him to tie in. Post the tie-in, we found out that the line he tied into was a private sewer line and not a public, not maintained and owned by the city. So we're having to go through some discussions with Mr. Hamby, the mayor's office, and Mr. Gaston. And is there anything you want to add to that?
Webster Street.
Webster. I said Weaver, didn't it?
Webster. The only thing that I would add.
Where on Webster?
It's about the second house on the left when you turn on Webster, right behind the.
They've tied onto the line that belonged to Shirley Walters and all the real estate that they had put in. I had communications with Greg, and we must have miscommunicated when we were talking. But I was not aware that he had tied on to it until I got a letter. Greg had understood that I had told him to go ahead and tie on. I certainly didn't intend to tell him that. But then somehow the municipal league got involved before I even knew there was an issue. And the municipal league had contacted the mayor without my knowledge, and had recommended to the mayor that they settle for $2,700.
With Ms. Walters?
With the Yeah, I guess, I'm not sure who it's with exactly, to be honest with you. Because I, all I know is what the limited amount that I've heard from Greg and Doug kind of after the fact. So,
yeah,
and it's kind of, as I understand what happened, we had one of our legislators that became involved in the issue, which was check files. And evidently the municipal league wanted to keep Jake Files voting favorably for the municipal league legislation. And I did receive an email from him, from Mark Hayes at one time early on, and told me that I needed to call him and talk to him about it. And I called him and talked to him about it. And after I talked to him, I called Troy, Mr. Gaston, and batted around what was going on to try to get educated on it. And I came away with that conversation with the understanding that the gentleman who tied on could probably resolve the whole situation for $300 or $400. And so I didn't think anything more about it until Greg showed up in my office and said that there was this phone conversation with Mark Hayes, and Mark had told Doug to pay $2,700. And when I called Mr. Gaston to find out why it was $2,700 instead of the $300 or $400, he told me that's what Mark Hayes had offered him, was $2,700. And as far as he was concerned, it's a done deal.
Did Mark Hayes, so, Mark Hayes didn't have the authority to offer him that.
I don't know.
I think Mr. Hayes would say he was in contact with mayor's office. And that's,
well, it's amazing we got a state senator involved in this dumpy little old house on Webster Street that should have been tore down. The house was being remodeled. I don't think the house sold for $19,000-$20,000.
There's a lot of politics involved.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of politics when Walter's Law Firm's in the backyard and they don't like us.
So, come talk to me. I'll share my thoughts with you.
Yeah, we can probably talk in private.
I'll share mine in public here in a minute. Go ahead.
But
well, I just shared my thoughts.
We did tie into a line that obviously was not a city line, it was a private line. So what Greg is doing now is working with Mr. Hamby on trying to create an ordinance that will protect us and keep us from doing those kinds of things going forward, to make sure that we identify the boundaries around what a private line.
I think this goes back to the days when we did the recoup fees, and
yes,
we've abandoned the
that's
recoup.
That's exactly right.
And that was a bad scenario in the first place. And part of why I think you're in existence is to keep all this mess from happening in Greenwood, while the Water Wastewater Commission.
Strike one.
is to keep this. Hopefully we're getting past this point, because this has been a recurring deal.
I think we would have been fine if we wouldn't have had the state senator and the municipal league get involved, and they would have just let us handle it internally. I think that we would have been fine.
So we're going to wind up probably settling this somewhere between $300 and $2,700, and then the ordinance will protect us going forward. Keep people from tying on multiple lines. You're not going to believe the number of residents are on this line. This is a large line. This is not a small line. It's not large in diameter, but the footage of this line is pretty significant. It goes all the way across Walter's Law Firm, and then back in behind the little Iger Mall there, and then goes the other direction as well. So it's a pretty significant line. But we've got it identified now, and we'll be able to wrap an ordinance around it, plus any others that are out there that this may, you know, this could be an issue going forward if we do this again. So.
And I don't know how it came into existence without us permitting it and having it dedicated, and that was back in the late 90s, I guess.
They did pay their tap fee, but.
I guess it fell through the cracks back then.
I think the municipal league costs us more money than they save us.
Well, basically, their response was we were going to pay them $3,000 to defend it anyway, so they saved us $300.
If I may, just real, and I have very little to add other than Mike, Mr. Hamby and I talked about this a little bit today, and I didn't more or less. I did apologize to him for not having him in the loop with my discussions with Mr. Hayes out of Little Rock. I actually thought Mr. Hamby was aware of Mr. Hayes' discussion with me, not on the same line or anything like that, but I thought they were kind of talking amongst themselves, and they weren't. It was through Mr. Gaston and yes, the other folks that had called. if I could say this without sounding too silly or anything, but if we end up, in my opinion, and that's all it is, because I'm learning as I go, by the way, how to get in stuff or how not to get in, try not to get in stuff too much, but if we can learn anything from this, and this is a little bit of advice for Mr. Hayes, that we, as a city, get our quote-unquote act together on what we know, what we own, and what we don't own, or finding that out. Now, that's not an easy task, and it's already been suggested or asked, how in the world did a line even end up in the ground without the city, quote-unquote, knowing it or not knowing it? You know, the one sitting here, now, I didn't know it, and probably neither, but no one else did, but the point is, it's there. And they're tying on, but we have a huge task ahead of us, or the commission certainly has a huge task of identifying these lines. It's just an opinion. If we're out that $2,700 to learn a lesson, to know what we're tying on to or allowing, I think in the long run we're going to be better off with that. If we go forward and, like I think what's happened in the past, and I'm not blaming anyone, anything, but we've seemed like I've stopped in my office several times and said, how did we get at this point in Greenwood, Arkansas, and not know the things we don't know? And that's not blaming or pointing in any direction. It's just happened that way over the years. And I know in 1968, I was living here, we got blown away. So who knows what happened that year or the year after, trying to get things back online, trying to get a city working again. So it's a lot of money. Mr. Hayes has suggested it. I have not signed any document to pay that amount of money. We certainly had those phone conversations, and that was suggested to me that we the city come up with 27 and Mr. Adams come up with the 300 to a total of 3,000. That paperwork and documentation has not made it back to City Hall yet, so when it does, I will not sign it until it's presented back to Mr. Hamby and the City Council to look and see what we need to do. But
well, we just need to make sure whatever paperwork is finalized, that it protects the city going
yes,
forward,
and,
so that
and,
we're not cleaning those lines out
and,
in the future.
Yeah.
Or any state
or further
code
even this
down that we yeah. have to
have we been
adhere to.
That line have we been cleaning the line?
We've replaced a couple of caps here and there because it's got a lot of clean outs on it. It doesn't have any manholes on it, but it has clean outs, so we replaced broken caps.
Let's put a labor and material fee in. Take that out of
there's probably
been maintaining it.
We have been maintaining it, and there should be something that protects the city, which we were looking for, that says if you're maintaining it for a number of years, then it automatically becomes.
That's a conversation I had with Greg, was that if we had, it's been in the ground for 7 years, and my understanding we were maintaining it after that length of time, then you can have a what's called a prescriptive easement in your line. And I think that whenever I explained that to him, that maybe it sounded like I was saying go ahead and tie on, but that's not what I intended. So
here we are.
All right. So when we write a check, the agreement's going to be we get the easement with the line.
That's right, yeah.
No?
I don't think
he says yes, and you say no?
We're not signing anything unless we get that.
The easement or take responsibility for the line? We don't want the line.
We don't want the line?
No. Okay. That line is not up to standards. We would have to go in and roof all that up and put new down. It's a six-inch line with multiple.
I mean, you get into a mess like we got at Shadow Lake. I mean, let's just take it, be done with it, fix it right. I mean, y'all are the Water and Wastewater Commission. Y'all.
Well, I'm going to base that recommendation off what Greg and Tim tell us, and Greg would say, I can't.
So what are we going to do when it backs up, and it backs up into one of them houses? Are we going to say, tough?
It's not ours. It's by the time
I mean,
we're
I'm just saying, though, they're going to come to us.
Well, I think that
we're protected there anyway.
Well, and again, the documentation and the paperwork that comes from Mr. Hayes' office will. I mean, if it doesn't say that, or if it doesn't have anything regarding that, I think we'll start all over with some conversations with him through Mr. Hamby this time.
But how many people are tied on to this line?
And make sure we're protected.
The I Group Mall is tied on to it.
Are they aware they're tied onto a private line?
I'm assuming they've been charged a fee to tie onto it, because that's what this is. It's a recoup fee. It's what they're trying to get. It's a recoup
so
fee
when you say you assume they've been charged a fee by the owner of the line?
Well, we collect
yes.
the recoup fee and then turn it back to the owner.
By the owner of the line.
We've abandoned that disastrous right. scenario. So.
Well, I just
plus,
I think
you have all more real estate
yeah.
that's tied into it.
Yeah. That's fine. If it's their line, and then we just need to make sure it's clearly delineated in whatever settlement we have that they're responsible for.
That's correct.
If the Water Commission recommends that we want the line and that it should be ours and better for us to have responsibility for it, then that's what we should try to do. But if their recommendation is, look, it's too costly for us to go try to fix this private line, and these guys have built a private line and been collecting money for people tying onto that private line, then it's their, needs to be their problem, and we need to make sure it's clearly their problem in the settlement so they understand that, sure, we'll pay the $2,600, but it's your line.
But have we
and all the people tied onto it are yours.
But have we not done in the past different to people? Are we treating them all the same?
Because I don't know that it's not come up here for me. I don't remember this.
When we abandoned that recoup fee, which was right after Paul Walker sued us over Forest Hills, right? Did we not treat Paul Walker differently than we'd be treating these people? I just want to make sure we're treating everybody the same. We don't.
I think you're fine. I think this is the settlement of the.
I just want to make sure there's a sewer bill going somebody.
Yeah.
There, we checked that.
Everybody in the law firm's offices, everybody's
well, I mean,
older, everybody in the mini mall.
Whatever line they put in ultimately empties into.
Absolutely.
That's correct. We charge the tap plus.
It's not any different than me having my own septic holding tank and pumping it up to the sewer line. And
we validated that they're getting a water bill and their sewer on the water bill. So we're okay there. That's the first thing we wanted to make sure.
But you're saying there's more than just this one house tied onto this line?
Yes.
I'm talking about residential, not commercial.
No, there's only one residential. It looks like there's two commercials tied in.
But they were in contact with the owner of the private line when they tied on, yes?
Yes. I think the people that own the line own
probably
the property at one point in time.
So yeah. We really don't, our really only deals with this one house that's been tied on.
At this point in time, it's just this one house.
So it'd probably be cheaper to go in there and move them to another line, wouldn't it, than $2,700?
They've already tapped on,
yeah.
Well, you can tap out. You don't have to stay with it.
Is it cheaper to tap out and move into one of our?
I don't care if it is or not.
That's
where's everybody else's sewer go on Webster Street?
Jim Dawson's
house. Oh, it's all septic?
He was on septic.
I'd rather pay him $2,700 to go back to septic.
This gentleman was on septic. When we remodeled the house, he wanted to come into city sewer, so he...
I mean, have we talked to him that he's on, we've tapped him improperly? Have we talked to the guy?
Yeah, we're having conversations with him. I'm not sure.
His attorney.
Yeah, his attorney.
The guy.
Which is the one that called Mr.
The guy that's done the remodel?
Yeah.
His attorney.
I don't know.
Mr. Gaston.
So.
Can I ask Eric a question?
So he's representing both sides of this?
On this map.
Is that Mr. Gaston?
No, I'm sorry. That's the Walters is Mr. Gaston. I'm not sure.
I'm just saying. If Gaston's the gallery model the house attorney.
No. The supposed owner of the sewer line.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So the guy that's remodeling the house.
Jake Files, I think, is not really
this
his attorney.
The but this is city sewer.
Adams is the name.
Well, if that's city sewer, I mean, I thought that's where the house was behind that. Walter's law firm. So why didn't the city sewer then?
The house is on this right here.
So is he going to be butt heads with Shirley Walters?
No.
Jake Files going to be going head to head with the Walters law firm on this deal? That we're trying to say?
No.
I want to see this.
No, he's kind of working with them.
So the guy's tied on illegally.
He's tied on legally. Now.
But to an illegal.
To a private line.
Right, so that's illegal.
And the privates, the people that own the private line.
Don't want him on there.
No, they're okay, but they want the fee paid. They want their fee. That's why they're charging $3,000.
What's their normal tax fee?
It's their recap.
Do they have a tap fee, their entity over there in the little community?
I think they're just trying to recoup the cost of trying to put the line in originally. I'm sure they charged a recoup for Almer. I'm sure they charged a recoup for the I group.
Well, it seems to me like we need to tell the guy to remodel, look, we erred here, we need to probably get you off of that and go back to septic, or you had to find a way to tie onto a line that's somewhere off. That would be my advice. I mean, the last thing I want to do is give money to some people that first of all, I don't even know when this private, how many private lines do we have in the ground in Greenwood, Arkansas? Do we even know?
That's was my point a while ago.
I mean, who was in charge of that deal?
We do not know that.
God.
No one here.
I think that would be a question for Mr. Hamby, if we can reverse his tap and say, stick on the sewer.
No, I don't think that's the way to go. I think that'll wind up.
Either way it goes, it doesn't smell very good, so.
Well, it is sewer. The $3,000 amount has not truly been explained. I mean, and again, it was $2,700 to the city and $300 for Mr. Adams. So I've not received anything to, I mean, I've had a phone conversation, more than one, with Mr. Hayes out of Little Rock, but nothing very specific about what this is for. I mean, not necessarily what's for, but, you know, why $3,000?
I'm about to tire rack checks.
I agree.
We're trying to fix the bell tower.
That's right.
All right, any other questions? If it helps any of the commission want involved in this discussion.
Hey, what time is that meeting on the 18th?
6:00.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Mayor?
Is that guy that did the remodel going to be at that meeting?
Probably not.
It's just standard.
Oh, this isn't a meeting talking about this mess?
The 18th is a meeting to talk about our standard commission meeting.
But this might probably come up, I'm sure.
We've already discussed it. We discussed it this last month.
Well, I'm glad y'all didn't let us know about it.
We did. That's why I'm here.
I mean, during that meeting. We can attend those, can't we? The wastewater commission meetings? Are we allowed to do those?
Absolutely. Yeah. I encourage you to come. Fourth Monday of every month, except for this month.
Public meeting.
It's a holiday.
Memorial Day.
Steve, holler at me on this, because I think I can get you a better interest rate.
What is it?
Okay.
Less than 1%.
Speaking of interest rates.
Bond.
On bond, Farmers Bank didn't want to have anything to do with this?
Right. They did not. They only do 5-year term on something like this.
Okay.
We checked. We checked with him first. Okay. John did. Bailey. Any other questions? But I will talk to Mr. Hamby about
the David Mims and I have been working on some projects. We've been getting some money for less than 1%.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy. Appreciate you. In the agenda, now it's time for the assistant forum. We have no one that has signed up on the sheet tonight to speak, but as always, I try to make sure that if you're not aware of the sheet at the back or the front, depending on which way you are, if you didn't sign up, I would give you that opportunity at this point. No one would like to. We'll move on. We have some agenda additions this evening. I've got a few myself. One would be the one that Michael or Lejean, did you mention the letter of intent or whoever mentioned it? I'm sorry. I have a letter of intent from Simon Cree in regard to the. I'm sorry. Right, Mr. Rattery. So I'd like to add that to the agenda if we could, with your approval. What number would that be?
Three.
One for new business? Number?
Three.
Not old.
It's just ordered consecutively.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Three.
Three and new.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can go right through.
Yeah. We don't start over? With new? Okay. We also have the handbook that you have in your packet that I'd like to add to the agenda and apologize for not getting these on there. So that'd be number four. It's a policy handbook. We have the resolution. Is that already? We don't have that on there. They already have the resolution. Okay, that would be number five.
Are you presenting
that? Do you want to, you put that down to present that, Ann, or do you want to just, okay. Finance Department, moving general fund. That's what I have on my list. I was thinking there was one more from someone, no department heads of agenda additions. Three is Simon Cree intent, letter of intent, statement of intent referred to here. Four is handbook, and five is from the finance department resolution. Am I missing someone?
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're good there. Going to old business, Mr. Hamby.
Once again, items 1 and 2 are the ordinances on the special election. I believe I made the changes that you had requested last month. I'm still working with bond counsel on the possibility of doing a bond issue on this. And that's part of what I was talking to Steve about. I may be able to, if we can bond this like I want to, we may be able to get it for less than 1% interest, which is unheard of. But I don't have an answer back on that yet. So it's just on for second reading. By next month, I'll have more details and will likely have bond counsel here to talk to you on the bonding issue.
Do they say it's a 10-year is easy enough to issue bonds on as opposed to like a 15 or?
That's part of what you're going to educate me on. I don't have the answer to that.
I'll make a motion. We put the ordinance calling for the special election for 3/4 cent sales and use tax on for second reading by title only.
Second.
Yes, sir. Let me get through this, then I'll call you back. Have it.
I was just wondering, on the, are we doing the first ordinance? Well, I mean, for the 10-year extension?
When I just made the motion, I was just calling for the special election.
I just wondered, there on the special election, there in the wording where it says for adoption or against, is there anywhere that where we can just still say that is the adoption of an existing or a continuance?
For extension instead of for adoption.
And I feel like you're still about to say for adoption. I don't know, but I need to say for the continuance or extension.
The top of the ordinance refers to an extension. That may be a question for.
Yeah, I will change that and have that on there next month.
Okay.
So I amend my motion to make that motion with that particular change.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
And Terry?
Yes.
And Terry?
Yes.
It's unanimous. An ordinance calling a special election in the city of Greenwood, Arkansas on the question of the extension of levying a 3/4 of 1% sales and use tax within the city of Greenwood, Arkansas.
Thank you. Second item, Mr. Attorney. Amy?
That's the other part of the
Mr. Mayor, we had someone in the audience who has one to make a comment.
I'm sorry? Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Newcomb, yes, you have come forward. Sometimes you have to throw something.
I'm paying attention to you.
Thank you. I know. I appreciate it. Sorry.
I've got some questions about this. Hope I look. Mr. Mayor, Ms. Clerk, Council, how y'all doing? This is tough for me to do because I'm missing Dance with the Stars. But I got some questions for you.
Okay.
How much is this special election going to cost? And Mr. Webb's here. I didn't know he was going to be here, but I'd like to know how much this special election is going to cost us. Have you all addressed that?
We have it in the budget and divided amongst several departments, and I can't remember. And you'd have to tell us again how much we budgeted for this special election.
Usually costs about $6,000.
That's what I was thinking.
Budget about 20 grand.
I think the police election would be a perfect example. How much did that cost?
We did not put it in there because we didn't know an amount.
So we haven't got
it.
We have 650 in special election in all funds.
Per department.
So for each fund.
Do you remember how much the special election cost for police?
I don't remember.
So it's a fair question that we don't obviously have the exact answer to, but
I thought it was around six or eight.
Sounds like we have budgeted around 6,500. If there's 10 departments, then we have 6,500 per department. So,
yeah, there's 10 departments. Yeah, that'd be about. Would that cover a special election in this city, Mr. Webb?
Mayor, Council, I think you're real close, but as you know, it's a city. You decide how many polling sites you have over there. You want to do all electronic, you want to do paper ballots. What's the danger of looking out of this?
Mike, you remember the.
This year?
Yes.
Late this year.
At that third, probably still have the opportunity to pay for electronic. Next year, maybe all electronic.
Okay. Yeah, definitely this year. We just, we did not set a date. We're just working on it to try to get it in by.
The paper, right? If you do paper and electronic, it's more effective.
Okay.
So I guess my question is, not, we got $6,500 budgeted, and that's pretty close to what it costs. So, and it's coming from each department. It's $650, right?
Correct.
Okay, that answers that question. Something I'm really concerned about is I haven't seen the ordinance that you guys have seen. That's just the way it is. Does it have a sunset clause in it, just like the last one?
10 years.
10 years.
10 year sunset clause.
Exactly.
We're not changing that. We're not pulling Gary Campbell.
No.
Okay.
The only thing that might make us consider altering that is if the bond people came and said, hey, look, it's hard to get a bond on 10 years. You need to do 12. But I don't think there's not good support for a from the council, I don't think, for one without a sunset clause. It's just how much time.
Yeah, 10 or 12. I don't think that really.
That isn't the bond issue that he's referring to is something that we did not do in the last tax.
Yeah.
In the passage, and we thought that was a good idea to, that's the additions that or changes right. That Mr. Hamby was referring to.
And I agree with that. If you're going to pursue it, try to get the bond. What exactly is the purpose of calling a special election next November when this tax runs out and will be voted on in November 16? And I've got my reasons for asking that, if I could tell you. The council, I think you're aware of it, in special elections, 12 to 15% of the voters, and I went back 25 years and looked, 12 to 15% of the voters in Greenwood go to special elections. It's not a whole lot. There's been a whole lot of things decided in this town. Four or 500 people have decided, and that's less than 10% of our electorate that's signed up in Greenwood. Although 2016 is going to be a presidential election, and in historical facts of the past, about 70 to 75% of our citizens go to electoral elections when it's a presidential election. So a lot more people go to the poll. I want to insert that I'm not advocating the defeat or the passage of the tax itself. My concern is, are the people fairly represented?
I think we're doing it early to get it in our budgetary cycle if it doesn't pass. That way we can start shutting down the Parks Department and shutting down.
Well, I understand that, Councilman Powell. I very much understand. That's a tough decision.
You're saying if we wait till November, then we got 6 weeks to start laying everybody off and quit.
The other thing about
totally
having it as a standalone issue for me is that when I go to the elections and vote, it can be confusing at times, even for me. Sometimes the list of issues when you go to a general election, especially one like the presidential election, there's going to be a lot of items that I'm asked to vote on at that election. And you know, to have this is an important issue for our community. And to have it stand alone as our community deciding yes or no, do we want to extend this tax, I think it's an important enough issue that for me, I would like to see it as a standalone thing for our community to decide on and not have it tossed in with general election issues that are going to be in the mix. That's part of the reason for me, too, is to have it as its own entity stand alone.
Councilman Johnson, I completely understand where you're coming from. The mayor and I had talked to, I don't remember where we were. I think it was a church parking lot. I think that's what we were. But I told the mayor,
police department,
if it was not for this 3/4% tax, which is streets, parks, fire, if it wasn't for this tax, my house would not be as worth as much as it is now. That's plain and simple. I mean, you get the things out there that look good, you keep everything up to date, makes my property worth more. It doesn't bother me that bad without saying how I'm going to vote on that tax. I'm just concerned about the fairness of it. I understand where you're coming from. If it did get defeated in November 16, the money runs out in 17. Like I said, you got 6-7 weeks.
Start figuring out how to shut everything down.
Yeah, that's.
That might give us more time to put it on the November ballot in 16, too, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Correct. Yes, that's exactly.
Give us a chance.
We have a second.
This is something that people, decide to vote against for a particular reason, let's say that if we get it out there and it doesn't pass, then it gives us a chance to come back and try to make a plan to vote for maybe a different tax that's worded differently, that's structured differently, so that we can go back and try to, you know, again, as Rod said, give us that safety net so that if we want to put something else on the ballot for 2016, we've got some time frame to put something different on the ballot if it doesn't pass.
I see what you mean, Councilman Johnson. And a lot of people say, that's not fair. You're putting it on twice. That's not fair. Well, I don't see it that way. I consider it being a proactive council.
Well, I don't know that we would put it on twice the same way. I mean, I think if you put it on this way and it doesn't pass, then you have to think about, okay, why didn't it pass? Is there something different?
Yeah. Well, okay. That's just all the questions I had. If you feel like it, take the A&P tax and put it on the ballot, too. Of all the votes I made in 6 years of being a councilman, that one haunts me, that I voted for an ordinance for the A&P tax. It was a 4-2 vote. If I voted against it, it would have been 3-3 that would have failed. I should have voted with those two right there.
You sat on the A&P. You're the longest. You sat on the A&P longer than anybody else.
If you put the A&P tax up for a vote, it would pass by blind vote, and everybody's seen how good it is.
He was talking in favor, I think. It sounded like you, a little bit you were against it there, Mr. Newcomb, but okay. I think there's
miscommunication. I'm saying let the people have their choice.
Smart. Okay. I would, and we can be done with that this real quick, but I would like to say, just to be on record, and when you, and I'm not disagreeing with you necessarily, but I do disagree with the, and if you're hearing it from citizens about the fairness of a special election compared to a general election, It's on a ballot, it's advertised, it's anybody can, and you're right, the percentage that shows up at a special election is very, very small compared to a general election, but it's as fair as the general. It's there to vote on, and everybody has that same right. So I see no unfairness whatsoever about it, something being on a special election. That's my personal opinion. I mean, I think a special election is specific about something that you need done, and you need done at a particular time. But everybody has the same chance to vote, I guess that's what I'm trying to say. So I don't disagree with what you're saying, but appreciate your comments. Thank you.
I make a motion we put the ordinance providing for 3/4 of sales tax on for second reading by title only.
I second it.
We have a motion and a second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
Yes.
Mike Terry?
Yes.
Unanimous. An ordinance providing for the extension of the levying of 3/4% sales and use tax within the city of Greenwood, Arkansas for a period of 10 years and prescribing other matters pertaining thereto.
Thank you. Thank you, Troop 1985, I think it was, or whatever. 89. 89, sorry.
85
was
a good year.
That was a good year? We won't ask why. Okay, thank you. We will move into new business. Number three, as we continue on, is the statement of intent, as it's listed, from Simon Cree. Mr. Redrick.
Council Mayor, you should have a copy of the letter of intent that has come before the Water and Wastewater Commission. I would have preferred that Simon Cree bond this project. That's the original direction we were going with them, is to get them to bond it. They had no desire to bond because they said it ties up their ability to give money, which I understand ties up their capital. So what they did do in lieu of the bond, though, was they're going to escrow it. They're a portion of it. They're responsible for 1/7 of the project. So what you see is a letter of intent that Mr. Hamby put together that identifies them escrowing their money. Or he worked on it. I'm not sure. Did you draft it from scratch, or did you?
I drafted up the first proposal, but it's been batted back and forth 2 or 3 times, and I've met, I don't know how many times, with Tim to get his blessing on it, and that's the final version that Tim said that he was comfortable with, and that he indicated the Water Commission was comfortable with.
We're comfortable with it as well. We're hoping that they close on the property within the end of May. Time frame, I think, is what they're shooting for, correct, Mayor?
That's correct.
So once they close on the property, I'll feel a little bit better about the whole deal, because, you know, if they don't close on the property, and they've been here, they've talked to the mayor, they're committed to this, but you know, until they put some blood on on the ground, then you really don't have a commitment. But hopefully they'll close on the property, and we'll have the money put in escrow to cover their portion of the project.
So just need to wait till next month to get blessing or vote?
No,
actually we need to move forward, because that gives them a comfort. Some of their legalese are in that, and they want to see that. Plus it gives us the opportunity to go ahead and award the bid. We haven't actually awarded that bid to the contractor yet. We've opened the bids, we picked the lowest bidder, but we haven't notified the contractor out of Russell.
So I need a quick finance lesson on escrow versus bonding.
Well, our intent was to have them bond the entire project.
Right.
That way, if they decided to pull out,
like everybody else has done to the city,
and $250,000 that
right.
we put in the ground.
This happened to us about four or five different times, and that I swore wouldn't happen again while I was sitting up here.
Yeah.
Now, I understand tax base coming to the city and jobs and all that stuff. That's for sure my number one priority, but.
So what they're doing is putting 1/7, which is their portion mm-hmm. of that line. We took that line. It was $212,000 plus $32,000 in engineering, so about $250,000. We divided that by seven property principals. There are seven owners of property there, and Simon Cree is responsible for 1/7. So as other people step up to the plate to tie into that line, they'll pay that same fee to the city.
So this won't be a private line?
No, this would be the city's line.
1/7.
So the expectation would be that as that property develops, as other tract owners come and tie into that line, they would pay a seventh of the
fee. Correct. That's correct. And this is what we're going to try to do as we also start that commercial corridor down 71 back toward Denver. We're going to do the same thing there. We're going to try to get someone that's interested, put the pipes in the ground, and then start charging these tie-in fees, whatever you want to call them.
So tell me that this is as good as a deal as bonding, or same as, or equal value.
For that portion, not
for that portion. Like I said, I would have preferred to bond the whole thing. If
right.
they'd have bonded the whole thing, that way if they walked away from it, we spent $250,000, we get $250 back, and we're done. But they weren't going to go there. So all they're doing is...
In fairness, though, I mean, they're bonding their portion.
They're bonding their portion.
And it's going to be our line
with
and our
cash.
Commercial development.
And it could attract other businesses to see that the line's already there.
We ask about as much as we think we could, and realistic, well, actually it was unrealistic, to be honest with you, I think, for them to bond the whole portion.
Steve, when it says water services, is that water and sewer, or is that just...
No, it's just there's already sewer back kind of down in the valley there behind the vet clinic. There's a sewer there, so they can tie into that too. But we're not putting the sewer line along the highway.
So the water tap for the other six, it's going to be...
Would be the same amount.
The same.
This is new.
Which we don't want, I mean, there's no one lined up to do that. We know, I mean, but we feel very confident, or we feel confident that as we build this, sure. And the city is, Tim's not here tonight to say this, but this was not in this year's budget. I think the Water Commission could probably back it up and say this was probably going to be in next year's budget.
No, we actually didn't this year's budget.
I mean, the whole line, yeah, I know you did now, but if this maybe
no,
not.
No, this was not a priority.
Right.
This was definitely not a priority because we were concerned with the water tank issue.
Right.
But in lieu of the city trying to get this business here, it became a priority for us as well.
Well, I just think that you look other places where there's a Walmart, there's a lot of other businesses right there adjacent to Walmart, you know, and I still think that, you know, all businesses need water. And I think that with the extension of that water line, you know, that there, those spots there on the Spur 10, you know, would I think, you know, be more inclined to develop that area.
Oh, absolutely. I think people are just watching and waiting.
So as other people tie onto this line, the $33,000 and change will get paid. That'll be it.
That's correct. And by the time if we get all seven principals paid, then we'll have the water line recouped.
That makes sense.
Well, I'll make a motion we pass the statement of intent. What's the right wording there?
Authorize
the mayor to execute the statement of intent.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
Terry?
Yes.
Lancaster?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Any other questions? Thank y'all.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you. And let me just say real quick, this letter of intent has taken, Mr. Hamby referred to 2 or 3 times. I think we're talking more about 5 or 6 times back and forth. And it's not because it was all completely, it was just little things, but we literally went back and forth. So there has been a lot of people worked very hard, from Brooke, I mean, just all through the a lot of folks have worked back and forth. And there was never a better day when we saw, and I'll just give you a real brief, and I know I talk a lot, but I was standing out front in the lobby there one day with a couple of folks, and a gentleman walked in the front door, and we greeted him as we always do, and he said he needs to speak too. I've never seen him before in my life, and he said, I need to see Sonny Bell. And I said, are you really sure? Didn't know him. I just kind of gave him a hard time. He said, yes, sir. And I said, well, he's right back here. And about 15 minutes later, Sonny brought him back out front, and it was Josh from Simon Cree from Arizona. So it was nice that a person showed up, because we'd been talking to some folks on the phone for a long time, many, many phone calls. So very nice. He went out to see the property, and it was just, so things are coming together. And this is going to be huge for the city of Greenwood. I appreciate lots of people helping and making phone calls, and certainly Sonny on the phone. I think Sonny was the first one to talk to these folks on the phone, and then Michael, of course, and just a lot of folks. So thank you for getting this approved, and we can move forward. Thank you. Next item is, if I'm reading my notes right, the handbook. I was telling department heads this morning in our meeting that I really wanted to get this. Brooke's been working very hard on this. Back to you guys. We're encouraged, and I know we've talked about Municipal League a little bit tonight, not such a positive manner, but they are who they are, and they do help us on other occasions. And this is one particular item that they're very animate about getting something in place. They feel like we're kind of out on a limb a little bit about getting something in place. And I know the handbook has been tossed back and forth literally probably the last couple of administrations trying to get this thing approved by everybody. And it's a huge document that I told the department heads this morning, or asked the department heads to consider this, about giving their thumbs up. And we got that approval this morning to give to you, believe it or not. And if you can question them if they're here, if you want to like to know their story. I didn't want to go into great detail on it. Brooks worked very hard on this. We have been in contact. I think Mike has chimed in somewhat on this, and certainly two different lawyers at Municipal League trying to get this like it needs to be. It's not perfect. I know as well as most people do, and it usually affects employees only as they need it. And if one thing, you know, if they've got a broken leg and they want to know how to get fixed, they'll go to this and look at broken legs. I'm being not exactly, but so they don't necessarily use it all the time. But it's important for us to get something in place for protection of us and for our employees. So that being said, if you have questions or comments, or and you might want to ask Brooke May can tell you, or I don't know May about it. She can tell you what we've taken out that didn't seem like it was handbook material and that sort of thing. So
I've actually skimmed through this thing. I thought it was pretty good, actually.
And again, it is, as it says, I think it says on it, or it says somewhere, it does, non-uniformed employee. Of course, so this does not regard to the police department nor the fire department.
That's the way it should be.
Yeah.
Because they have their own.
Absolutely.
So is it imperative that we pass it tonight, or can we just kind of have a chance to really look over it and pass it for?
Bert, to remind me of what the two things that we need done to.
Do we need to pass it, or is this an administrative?
I'm not going to pass it. I'm pleading that you will at least adopt the discipline and the outlaw policy, because that's what we're in conflict with in our old handbook.
Administration can pass, you know, have policy, but it's not official policy until the council adopts it. We make policy. So yes,
the handbook, it is policy.
Is that correct?
Correct. However, I would say this would be deemed more of an administrative. This would fall, I think personally, under administrative action. So if the mayor is good with the book, I personally am good with the book, with the handbook. So it's kind of like the mayor is our commission on this deal. If you say you're good with everything in there, I know for sure I am. I don't have any problem passing it tonight. There's not really any reason really not to, I don't think. I mean,
well, and on that note, you, and you can correct this, Mr. Hamby, we can get this passed. I mean, I very much encourage you to. I would like for you to. So I just feel better about it. We have a policy handbook, and we should have one, and it should be intact. Can we come back and change it? I think we can, just like we do an ordinance. So if there's something that's not right or doesn't work well, or you see that needs tweaking, we'll come back and undo it. Not the whole book, hopefully, but just a revision.
Are we adopting this? Or are we passing this?
You're adopting.
I make a motion we adopt the student handbook.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to adopt this handbook.
Hold on before you take a vote. Yep. Did you want more time, Macy?
I mean, this is 24 pages. I'd like to really review it.
I've read it, and I'm perfectly fine with it. But if AC wants more time, I'm going to vote no, just because I think AC ought to have the prerogative to kind of look at it. But I like it. I read it. I picked it up last week, and I like it.
Rod, it's important to understand it's a living document. You're going to change that thing over the course of the year. You're going
to
change
it. He's just asking for some more time to review it. We've got one in place right now. It's just kind of
how long have we had this? I know, but I mean, how long have we had when these were emailed to us? I'm pretty sure. And I don't even check my email, and I got it.
And I've got it, and I've read it.
So,
well, I guess I was just looking at the holidays. You know, I mean, I know typically it's 10 holidays, a year. And here it looks like we're granting 13 holidays.
That's all we've had.
That's not changed, I don't think.
All the time. We haven't added.
Yeah. What page? Mr. Brown, what page?
Page 9.
9, okay.
And so that's not been any change there?
No.
Mm-mm.
Just page 24, the very last, since we're being very detailed about this and we want this part to be right. There's just a couple of typos on the second paragraph. The very last sentence, it says me and either part, I think it's party. And then with our or without part, pause needs to be or, just to make sure that is all clear to everyone. Because that's the part they signed. We'll just make those.
And either party?
Yes. And then reading on there with or without cause, this is our.
I'm sorry?
With or without cause, it just says our. With our or without cause, it just needs to be you taken out.
I'm not seeing what you're with. Yeah. Or not our. Got it.
But I mean, even if they adopted that page, Rook, would that help that very last page? No. Where the lawyer acknowledges. Yeah, because could. They have to have, they're acknowledging the whole book on this, right?
We cannot let another employee go without adopting our at-will statement and the way we discipline and review disciplinary actions.
We were very close, without going into any details, which I absolutely won't, couldn't anyway, but we were very close to be getting in trouble.
Right. Well, if you're saying if that's really the major changes of it, it's just the at-will and the disciplinary sections,
well, the
then I'm
vacation
okay with that.
Policy is different as well for employees. I have to, since you've said that, there's changes.
We're not trying to say there's not any changes. I mean,
no, I'm saying those are the pertinent parts. If you're not going to adopt the whole book, we need to at least take those two pieces and insert them in our current handbook.
The only, and I appreciate your questions, Mr. Brown, and I am not questioning what you have to question. My only concern is that we've had this out in your packet for, I guess, a couple of weeks.
Well, he says he's okay, so we've got a motion and a second.
Okay.
All you got to do is call for a vote.
Okay. I would call for a vote if you're through discussing. I didn't want to interrupt your discussion.
And he says he's happy with it, so.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
Yes.
Ms. Terry?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I shall sleep a little better. Thank you. Finance department.
This is actually a resolution the mayor asked me to prepare this morning for
the study session that's to happen after this meeting. We have budgeted $2,500 in economic development. There's also in the budget $5,000 to be saved at the, you know, for the course of 15 for future economic development projects. The economic development project the mayor is considering is $11,500. So we need to transfer an additional $4,000 from general cash in bank to
all we're doing by doing this is signing off on the transfer of the budget. We're not signing
transferring
off on what
the $5,000 from savings
yet.
To economic development, and then increasing economic development by an additional $4,000. So putting the total amount instead of $2,500 to $11,500.
And it's for what? It's for what we may do
well,
after
it's
this
for
meeting.
What may happen after
it's just
after
increasing the budget. He might decide to use it for something totally different or...
Well, he'd have to use it for economic development.
Yeah, but what particular way he uses it for economic development is not going to be mandated. It's just how much is in the budget for economic development.
Correct. That's correct. And I will tell you, and we have $5,000, as Anna suggested, in savings to transfers already there. It's not line item, it's budget, it's in savings. We have $2,500. So the increase is nine, as it says right here. This is a little, I suppose it's somewhat backwards, but I wanted to get, I assure you, and that we'll discuss this in our study session, that this money is for economic development. I would come back to you before spending it on any project and get
well, blessing. Can we go ahead and have the discussion first and find out what we're trying to spend it on?
We can't add the resolution to a study session.
No, but we can have any discussion we want at this meeting. If we want to insert said study session into this discussion right now, we can. And right. I don't know how in-depth the study session is going to be, but
I'd like to know.
How about this? How about we... Okay, can I make a motion? I guess I can.
You can. You certainly can.
So our suggestion, so we've got, I suggest we table voting on this resolution until after the department head reports. With the understanding that the department heads be brief with their reporting. You know, I don't want to be here till midnight hammering out some study session, but we haven't. We don't necessarily even have to have a study session if we want to incorporate whatever discussion we want about this resolution into the meeting. I just hate to have guys sitting out here, department heads waiting to give their report, sitting through an hour-long discussion, or however long that's going to be. But a 15-minute discussion. I don't want to set the bar too high.
I just, didn't we give the mayor, didn't we raise his authority on what he can...
That's why we should have all this discussion before we vote on this resolution, I would say.
I'm like Rod. I want to know what we're doing, where we're going, and all that stuff before, because I mean, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to vote no on this.
So all I want to do is move that discussion to after,
after
the department heads.
But either way, I want to have that discussion of what we're doing and which direction we're headed and what we're looking at maybe spending it on before
I agree.
That's absolutely fine, and this was...
Let's table that till after the department heads give their discussion.
Okay. Very good. Department head reports, Chief Dawson, you're right there.
Mayor Council, Ms. Derrick, Mr. Holmby. Last month, we answered 345 calls for service. That's compared to 198 this same time last year. 25 motor vehicle collisions, issued 123 citations, 249 warnings. There were 59 people arrested. That's compared to 39 April last year. The arrest breakdown, I try to do that every once in a while just to let you know what type of arrests we're making. Last month, one aggravated assault, five domestic batteries, four breaking or entering, five DWIs, one driving while license suspended for DWI, 14 drug arrests, two hot check arrests, one minor in possession of alcohol, one obstruction of governmental operations, one residential burglary, four shoplifting, one terroristic threatening, two trespassing, and 16 warrants.
Derek, can I interrupt you?
Sure.
And I hate to interrupt you, get you off that. The drug arrest, what kind of drugs what do we have here in Greenwood?
Meth, marijuana, and pills, basically.
They're prescription pills?
Yes. Yes. That they don't have a prescription for.
Somebody else.
Apparently they have a pharmacist that's not licensed.
How much of that is meth?
14. I think there are 4 meth arrests.
Okay. Sorry for the interruption.
No problem. Training, Detective Deere continues to go to the crime scene certification program. He does that 1 week out a month for 6 months, and this is his 5th month now. We had our range qualification where everybody qualified. The sheriff and I were two of 25 law enforcement executives that are invited to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children for a pilot program that's on child exploitation. That was a 2-day course in Alexandria, Virginia. CID was assigned 17 new cases. They closed 15 cases. Year to date, they've been assigned 88 cases and have closed 82 for a 93% closure rate. Community relations special assignments, April 7th. Dennis Wisner did a canine demonstration for Hartford Schools. April 11th, Josh Martin and Jonathan Bass, they provided, I believe it was security / directed traffic for the grand opening of the Hellfighters Motorcycle Club there on Highway 96. Sergeant Davis refereed Special Olympics basketball at Southside High School. Brad Hobbs did our drug take back where we collected 30 pounds of prescription medications, which from the last take back to this one, just people bringing in, we collected 400 pounds of prescription medication, whether it be expired or unused, that people turn in. I did the monthly talk on Spirit 106.3, and I spoke about child exploitation. Sergeant Mergen and Investigator Fugit worked the prom. And we also had 2 officers assigned to security at the hospital for the subject that was arrested that injured himself in the back of the patrol car. And he was a security risk for the hospital there. That is all I have.
Chief Dawson, I just wanted to mention that I think Officer Pippen, I was working late at night at the office, at my office. It was, you know, 10 or 11 o'clock, and I heard the door open, and it was Officer Pippen just going around doing door checks. And again, I sure appreciate them doing that. Thank you.
I think the business centers, every once in a while, they'll stick cards in the door, let them know that they're there. We've had phone calls that want to know what's going on, but they try to stick a business card in there every once in a while, let them know that they are checking doors and make sure businesses are secure.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it. Thanks for keeping us safe. Ann, Ice Department.
Kristen and I attended the workshop that the clerks put on, and it was a very good workshop. We gained from it, from the preparing for the audit, and then Department of Labor came and gave us wage and hour information. It was very informative, so it was beneficial to us as well. And we still have no word on the 2014 audit as to when that will take place. And city sales and use tax is down 2.1%, same month last year, but we're still up 4.1% year to date. And county sales tax is down 2.9%, same month last year, but still up 3.6% for the year.
And we're still working on 2013 tax. I mean, we've been assuming a flat for several budget years, right?
This is the third year that we've done it.
So we're working off 2013 or 2012. What's the tax base that we're using as our flat? Does that make sense?
We're doing it over 13.
So when I look at the little purple line, even though it's less than the green line, it's still quite a bit more than the red line, which is where we need to stay above to be making budget.
Right, and I don't feel comfortable increasing that when we're only like 2-3%. If we get to 5%,
I agree. I just want to make sure. it's a little reassuring to me. I don't like to see it dip below last year, but it's a little reassuring to me to see that it's still above 2013. So, and that's the base we're working off of.
Any questions?
Thank you, Ann. Appreciate you. Chief Brian?
Mayor, Mr. Hammy, Mr. Derry, Council. Fire Department, chief activities for April 2015. We had three false alarms, one structure fire, one mutual aid fire incident, two motor vehicle collision with injury incidents, three hazardous condition incidents, 47 rescue medical incidents, and two mutual aid incidents for a total of 59 calls. One of those was in Shadow Lake area. Training. Our officers are about to finish up over 800 hours of training that we've done so far this year with officers and potential officers through Officer One. I've got several guys going through first responder training. They've done over 120 hours so far this year. I attended a fire marshal training on NFPA 96 for about 12 hours of training. And we had our dam break tabletop exercise and had several members attend FDSC. We're trying to up our training quite a bit, try to meet ISO needs, and it's always beneficial. The more training we do, it's more beneficial for the department. But right now, our training officer and I are going through and trying to identify how we can match what ISO is asking us to do and try to make it better. But their goals are pretty much unattainable by anybody but three departments in the state that have ones. They're all full-time departments that are very large. I think West Memphis, Rogers, and Searcy are all ones now. But if you look at all the training on there, you wonder when they get to fight fire. So it's pretty intense. On public relations, fire prevention, we visited the Church of Nazarene Children last month. We've got a visit to the station scheduled for the East Point first grade. Did inspection, fire marshal inspection over at Senior Citizens Center, and quite a bit of plan review on the Freshman Center. Our grants, I got some positive news. Since I think 2010, we haven't made it out of the computer, and we actually made it out of the computer on our grant this year. We've done the panel for the grant for the mobile live fire training unit. It's a $175,000 unit. We'll have to pay 5%. And so we'll see how that goes. And if we can do that, that'll also help ISO, because that counts for you. Equipment, we had the Polaris serviced. Pump testing was scheduled for this week for all of our pumpers. Engine 1 and Tower 1 pumps are going to have some small repairs done in the next week or two. And at Station 1, we had the RPZ installed for our sprinkler. The landscape, we're going to have it inspected this week, as is required. And MHG is still working on our preliminary plans for the addition. I think we have the engineer today looking at all the electrical. Do you have any questions?
Chief, I meant to tell you, I work with a guy that's on the fire department over there at Bloomer. What's that? Is this Bloomer Volunteer?
I believe so.
Anyway, he came up here to, you had a deal, I think, at the Bell Park Pavilion a while back. Or at the school, one of the two fire chiefs.
That was a school.
At the banquet.
Yes.
Yeah, and he was overwhelmed and said it was awesome. I just wanted to pass that word. I meant to tell you that. I don't know how long ago that's been, but yeah, he said it was a really nice deal.
Yeah, that turned out to be real nice. I had the mayor go do our intro. Wasn't sure how that was going to go. As usual, he makes fun of the fire chief.
Right.
So in front of all the other fire chiefs,
you would have enjoyed it.
So, anyway, I want to pass that on. I meant to tell you that.
Thank you, Chief, and thank you for also keeping us safe in our city. Appreciate you. Sonny, Planning Department. While he's on his way, let me tell you that joke that I told at the... Okay.
Mayor, Councilman, Ms. Derry, you have my report in front of you. Planning and Building Department this last month issued permits to two new houses, two pools, total construction value of $416,980. The Greenwood Freshman Center project's moving right along. construction plans were submitted April 23rd and are waiting for approval from Fire Marshal and Building Department. All other departments have approved. DSC project has had the civil and construction plans approved and will soon go out to bid. You see the meetings that I attended in Donning last month. But animal control code enforcement, Joseph had 30 code enforcement calls. He's been working on cleaning up some of the tall grass already. He's already issued warnings to 11 properties, so that's only going to go up in the next month or so. Two citations were written in April, one for a structure at 411 Henry Street for debris and improper wiring, and another for an unpermitted building at 409 Bell Park Drive. He had 53 animal control calls, transported 8 of them to local vets, 9 of them to the Sebastian County Humane Society. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Sonny. Look around, who's here? Joe, Street Department.
Mayor, Council, Ms. Derrick. We started our citywide cleanup this past Saturday. We had 126 customers come through. Been taking care of drainage. That's never ending. So, any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Joe and I have been discussing quite a bit the drainage issues, and we'll come back with some details on some major plans as far as cleaning up and getting some of this drainage stuff taken care of. And he's working pretty good hard on that. And I witnessed the cleanup, citywide cleanup, went down myself, and they were very efficient. Two backhoes going 90 mile an hour, if you will, and people coming and going. It was a big, big, big success. I'd encourage you. That's all this week, right? Probably.
Until 6 o'clock.
Six.
And then Saturday.
Okay. So that's
7 to 2
Saturday. Okay. Thank you, Joe. I think that's all department heads here. Richard's already spoke on behalf of the Parks Department and the Commission. Thank you guys for that. Any questions from council, from anybody regarding any of that? We'll go into this discussion, I think, regarding the finance resolution. Keep saying finance. She presented it. Thank you. Thank you. As you know, we're working very hard. There's several people working very hard. We have an economic development committee in place. We have a few members here tonight on that committee, being, and I'll try not to forget anybody, Gary Grimes is on it. Lee Webb has been put on it, whether he wanted on it or not. Show up in meeting, we're gonna put you on it. Sonny Bell, Cheryl Garner is here. Michael Lejeune is our chairman. Brooke Holland is on the committee. Chief Bryan's on the committee. No, he's not. Jeff Bryan, I'm sorry, in the back there's on it. I don't know why. We don't want Stuart on her. Colt Rogers, a local quote-unquote little realtor guy, that's what we're calling him. I'm surprised he's not here. He's very excited about anything to do with economic development. He's about to implode about things happening in Greenwood, Arkansas. Am I missing Phil Hicks, Randy Davis, Stanhope Wilkinson, Lee Johnson, sorry, Councilman Johnson. sir? Randy, yes. John Ciesla. Just a great group of people. We've met 5 or 6 times, Michael, 4 or 5, I don't know. Seems like 100. We've met several times. We talked back and forth. I know that, and he's reported on this a couple of times. I didn't get to go to Clarksville with them. They went to Clarksville. I did get to go to Poto. We talked to the mayor over there and just finding out how other cities are doing economic development and seeing if we can not copy them, but find out good ideas and ways to do it. So we have made, I say we, they have made some huge strides, and this TSC project is a product of that, and hopefully that thing will be buttoned up soon and we'll move on down the road and continue to do other projects. These folks are just constantly on the phone, whether they're at their own jobs or here at City Hall doing their job and working hard to see that Greenwood grows in a timely but effective manner, and therefore this infrastructure regarding the water line, things like that. So, some exciting things happening. Cheryl Garner, is on our committee, but she works for a company, and I will probably ask Cheryl if you're okay with that to come and just discuss this contract that you've brought to our attention as far as the committee goes in a minute and let you ask questions. The committee, and I'm not, to be honest with you, it all kind of happens so fast and we're trying to get things moving and not miss out on things, although you never know what you're going to miss out on. And economic development is, I think Mr. Grimes will agree that it's a very different animal of any other kind, and Mr. Webb too, that it's just something that you grasp and grab a hold of when you can, as you can. But that being said, it's a little different than hiring or buying something or hiring a different kind of service. Let me back up. I asked Ms. Garner to come in to our last Economic Development Committee meeting and discuss her contract or this contract with the committee, have them ask questions, see what they thought, and then I wanted that to be brought to council in some form or fashion, and that's what we're doing right now. So I'll just let Ms. Garner, if you don't mind, come up, and is that okay with you to do that?
So to be clear, the reason we're wanting to pass the resolution is to increase the budget so that we can enter into a contract with Ms. Garner's company.
That's correct.
To do some economic development consultation.
That is correct.
Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Just want to make sure everybody knows that's correct.
Yes, I'm sorry. I didn't. Sometimes I talk a lot and never say anything. Works as if she did.
Hi, my name is Cheryl Garner, Mayor, Council. I know several of you, and it's nice to see you. I do economic development, and I have been working with the committee in a volunteer capacity. And some exciting things are happening. You guys have discussed one of those exciting things, but we have the opportunity. Economic development is one of those things that I don't want to talk about too many specifics in a public meeting. And so I will talk generally, and then we'll talk as specifically as we can without talking very specifically. But generally speaking, Greenwood has the opportunity to really grow the assets that are here with regard to economic development. And generally, when we talk about economic development, we talk about wealth creation that comes from without side of the community, or the creation of wealth through the creation of jobs or capital investment in the community. And so as we've worked with this community or with our committee, we have the opportunity to pursue and to recruit industry to Greenwood to increase jobs and to increase capital investment in Greenwood. And the proposal that I have before you is rather short. It's a 60-day proposal, which is a short time frame when you're working in economic development. Typically, a project that you might work on might take several months. But the reason the time frame is so compressed is that we want to put some intense effort towards a project in the near future, as soon as possible. And so that's why it's a short time frame and it is compressed. There's a 60-day time period there, and so there's an intense amount of work that needs to be done rather quickly. And so what we're talking about is the recruitment of industry to Greenwood, which would bring job creation and capital investment.
And the pressing nature of this is that there are some opportunities potentially available.
There are some very specific opportunities that we don't want to, identify what those are, but there are some very timely opportunities, and as a member of the committee, work has already started to pursue those opportunities. But when you're competing to recruit an industry to a specific location, and particularly if you've identified a company and that company is interested in your community, if they are already looking for sites and already talking with other communities, then they are actively working to locate. And so then you have to actively pursue them. And so we do have at least one, possibly two, possibly three, that are related that need some intense effort.
So, yeah, so I think, you know, from my standpoint, sitting on a lot of these Economic Development Committee meetings now, and listening to the evolution of what that's been. You know, it started with just a small group, and really Michael's been one that I think has been a big leader in that economic development. The idea that we'd have a committee, I mean, you said four or five meetings. We've been doing this for 2 years, something like that. It started out as a very small thing, and we went to meetings up in Northwest Arkansas trying to get an idea of how do communities like Poto, which has a lot of industry in it, or and doesn't have, you look at Clarksville and say, well, they've got I-40 running through it. Well, Poto doesn't have I-40 running through it. They've got a bypass that they build, but they don't have, so you can look at Poto and say, why can't Greenwood be more like that? What are the things that communities like Poto has done to draw industries, businesses to the area? And even went and met with their mayor and asked about some of the things that they've done. And one of the things that's the common thread that you hear is a willingness to invest in this sort of nebulous entity that's economic development. And I know that it's a little bit hard sometimes to invest money in something that you don't have a clear grasp of what you're getting, but the one common thing that we're seeing when we go to these communities is at some point the city's ponied up some money to try to specifically work towards this idea of drawing people here. I think this idea of relying on the chamber, relying on some of these other things that we've done, it's not been working. And this is an opportunity, I think, to take what's relatively a small amount of money to the city for the potential benefit that's there. And I think most of the people, all the people on the committee, it's a good group of people, it's a broad group of people within the community, and all of them would support this idea. So it's obviously something that I'm in favor of. I don't know if y'all have questions about it specifically.
There are committee members in this room?
Yes, yeah. There's several.
Do y'all agree with that? Do y'all all think this is a great idea and we need to move forward?
And I think there were a lot of questions the other day. We met the other day and we talked about it. Some of my questions the other day, I think we need to relate those to you, was the fact that in fact it's an incorporated group out of Utah that was handling this contract. But also, I understand that
that is what it says, yeah.
I do work for Utah Corporation. The work would be handled by the Arkansas office, which, as you may be able to see on my letterhead, is Greenwood, Arkansas. So the work, you're correct, Gary, in that the corporation is out of Salt Lake City, and my parent company is a civil engineering firm that's about 110 years old in Salt Lake City, and we do work nationally, and I work across several states. So yes, it's a national firm.
I think what he's getting at is that we don't like the fact that if there's a disagreement, we're going to have to litigate it in Utah. Or under Utah law, we would want that to be Arkansas.
That would be concerning to me.
Yes,
and it is. It may not. I can only issue a consultant based on what I think, and it would be concerning to me that the under Utah law, about anything like that.
Right. And I think that is a valid concern.
So it's easy to get down to the...
So what does that mean in plain Jane?
Well, it means we'd want her to change it. We'd want to change that clause to say Arkansas law is the Utah law, which would be something you'd have to take back to your corporations if they were willing
to do it. I would have to see if we could do that.
I guess I was asking more what are the implications of that.
You're going to have to hire a Utah attorney.
Okay.
Yeah. somebody with a Utah license.
Okay. You cannot represent us or no one from Arkansas. You have to be licensed.
We would have to associate with somebody that had a Utah license.
Yes. My son is a dentist, cannot pull up tooth in Texas.
This has the look of a sheet of paper that somebody pushed a button in a big company somewhere and spat it out and stuck on a contract.
Well, that is...
They're not doing any contract. Do you think that's a point of contention? You think that if you pulled up, I would suspect that question, if it's a company that has contracts in multiple states, I suspect that's a common question.
And something that goes along with that is that, for instance, like 2.1, it says something that any service is not listed for our additional business, like a construction contract. If someone were to want to build something, there would be an additional charge under this contract, would be an additional charge, a percentage charge over and above the consultant.
We do work nationally. And I have to say, this is the first time in any of the states that I've worked that I've been asked to change that. It is our standard professional services agreement. So yes, our firm, that is our PSA that we use with all of our work. So this is the first time I've been asked to alter that. And I've worked in Arkansas. One of our major clients is the city of West Memphis, Arkansas, and our firm has several very large projects that we've been working over a multi-year period with the city of West Memphis, Arkansas. So I do have a list of references which you're welcome to contact.
Well, I was just wondering, I guess along that same vein, and I appreciate you bringing that up, Gary, but I was thinking just like with the Simon Cree, they're in Arizona. I mean, when you enter anybody, I mean, was that the same kind of stipulation apply? I mean, we're entering basically an agreement, with a company outside of the state again.
In the agreement that we just talked about with Simon Cree, that's going to be under Arkansas law.
It'll still be under Arkansas law.
Yeah. Unless you have a provision like this that where you agree that it's going to be in some other state, then it's in the state where the contract is.
Okay.
So this is somewhat unusual. This is pretty typical, like on credit cards, that kind of stuff. They put that file print in there.
So from the committee standpoint, the idea of spending money to hire a consultant or spending money on economic development would be something in general the committee's in favor of. But the specifics of the legalities of this contract are questions to. Is that a fair? Yeah, right.
I don't know that we've reached the point that we've got $7,500 and $5,000 that we can come back to you as council and ask for more money for a board itself. You're asking me? That in fact, I'm a consultant. I get paid monthly, and we may be passing something up really good. I'm not sure. I'm not sure we're at that point in our early stages of economic development that we add a bunch of dollars to the consultant fee, looking for something to bring in. I don't know if that's the way. I think I would like to just continue to work like we are, and it's been very good to put all of us working together. We've had some success. Hopefully, we'll have some more success. I'm not sure where we stop at what point. Maybe you understand that. How poor do we stop? We stop at 5,000, 11,500. If there's more leads later on, at the end of 60 days or 90 days, whatever it might be, if there's more leads, do we get them more at $5,000?
Well, I think the difference in where you have been, so the committee has gotten us to a certain point, and the committee did have a lead that was identified, and I pursued that lead, and we're getting very close to having an industry that probably hasn't been discussed at all here. And associated with that is a very nice opportunity And so where we are is that we can intently pursue that opportunity or not. So we can continue at the same level that we've been and probably miss the opportunity, or we can pursue it and try to attract the opportunity. And it's a good opportunity.
Well, I mean, again, I sure appreciate Gary, because I would have completely missed that, you know. And so I appreciate you bringing that to our attention about the, and I kind of will yield to, you know, our attorney about that, whether that might be a big issue or not. But I know, kind of heard what Dr. Lee has said, you know, that sometimes, you know, we rely on the chamber or you know, even y'all's, you know, committee to try to find opportunities for us. And sometimes just as a, just as a committee that y'all meet, you know, just monthly or whenever y'all do meet, you know, sometimes it can't not be the same as somebody actively doing it on a daily basis as a part of their job function. And I know that sometimes, you know, windows appear for a short time, and that we're just one city competing with several other entities, you know, cities, municipalities, trying to, for that same industry or whatever, and you sometimes have to strike while the iron is hot. And I hear what Dr. Lee said, I'm sure as the committee said, you look at some cities like Poto, which they, you know, they don't have a major interstate running through them, whatever, yet, you know, they have lots of industry. And that's where I really look at the committee, because while I want, you know, economic growth, I feel like that is, you know, a very key role in any city's, you know, growth. You know, I'd also like the Economic Development Committee to say that whether this is a worthy, you know, venture, or, you know, like some people say, it's not a bunch of maybe chicken processing plants, you know, lack of anything better than that. You know, while I'm not opposed to those, you know, still.
Well, see, all the places that we visited and the trip that you took up to Northwest Arkansas, the common founder of all building, and then when somebody moves into there, they sell them that building at a reduced rate of what you would buy if you had a general contractor build you a building. You know, in Clarksville, they had a group of people that came together that you know, put money into the pot along with the city, and they bought land out there on Interstate 40. So now they're selling that land at a reduced price to bring in industry. So, you know, is this a good idea or not? You know, that's your guys' decision. But each one of them have focused on different ways to be creative.
Can I ask, if I may, to interrupt, I guess, number that 2-1, Michael, is that anything that additional services, is that, I mean, I'm not asking if that's in your contract, but is that an unusual?
A lot of times we deal with contracts where we work with a national company, and they'll bring us their language, and then we've always edited the language to suit us. We never accept their stock language.
Right.
That's pretty standard practice for us when we're doing a national companies like a Gerber or Gerdau or anybody like that, because I don't want to abide by the law of some other state or some entity where they're located. So it's general practice for us to mark through both of those things. Sometimes we can never reach an agreement and we just walk away from the project. I mean, that's common for us, but we're working in a different field. I mean, we're working with guys who are building something. We're not talking about economic development at that point. So it is a little bit different. There's a couple other things in here. I mean, Gary mentioned there's a few of, you know, little things we're here that I highlighted that I mean, I would just walk up. Topic up, but we can get into more detail on that. But probably the one thing that I wanted to add with the conversation, you know, you listed off a group of people that were involved in this. There was really all of us came together based on Gary and Mayor's recommendation to kind of get started, start beginning to talk about economic development. It started very small, just like Lee mentioned. We built up, a lot of things weren't happening, but no one else on the committee really, but Gary and Lee and Cheryl deal with economic development directly. The rest of our group, we're all interested in it, but we all have different jobs, so we're kind of all relying on each other and each other's expertise to move us to the next step. Initially, when we came in and we talked to you guys, we had a UCA come in and do the community development assessment. They listed five bullet points, and their number five bullet point was working with the Arkansas Economic Development Commission and presenting project leads. So this is obviously a key thing they identified for us to work on. We've had some things come up, TCS, which we know about, the water line expansion project, which is going to add six more lots to that location based on some future projects. We're looking at tenant for one of our major empty buildings, and this is kind of what we're referring to now with Cheryl. But again, the committee is still young, and we're still trying to figure out what we're doing. And to me, this is a big step, but you don't make big steps without taking risks. But I don't have the expertise to say whether this is a good risk or not. I don't know that. So I'm kind of relying on some people that deal with this more on an everyday and closer relationship with economic development to say, yeah, we think this is a good risk. So I'm kind of relying on Gary Lee and Mayor and everybody to say what's next. I mean, what do we do? And we're bringing this back to you, really back for more discussion, because we don't know and we're not. So we wanted to get it out for discussion because it is a big step. When we started with nothing, and then we actually got some money put in the budget for this year. When we were excited and thrilled, we had 2,500. We're going around to all these other cities, and they've got 100,000 or 150,000 in their economic development pot. Well, we're excited we got something. And now we're up to that first step. Well, and 2,500 is not enough to really do anything or pursue a consultant, whether it's Cheryl or a different consultant. You're going to have to make an investment to move us forward. So, again, it's new ground, it's new territory for the committee, and it's a risk. And I'm still not 100% sure. You know, I'm not sure I'm ready to take the risk, but I'm also relying on the entire committee to say yes. And we haven't really, we wanted to get the discussion to you guys first, because you know it's a hot lead, and you know we need to move on it if we're going to do something. But the entire committee hasn't really met to discuss this. We've only met with the mayor and four or five of our committee members, Jeff was there. So the entire committee is not proud of moving forward to a contract for services. And of course, it'll actually be the city doing that contract. It won't be the economic development.
So the study session, so there's two issues here, Dan. There's this resolution, which is to move more money into the economic development budget, which I'm absolutely in favor of moving more money into the budget. The question then becomes, what are you going to do with that money? And I think that's where we all have a lot of debate, it sounds like, and uncertainty. And that's really what the study session was for, to flesh out some of that part of that. But because of the cart and horse issue here, we got to get out some of the, I would like to make a motion that we move the additional money into the economic development fund.
Line item.
Yeah, line item. But with the caveat being that the mayor not, you know, he can't enter into any agreement or contract or anything without our approval. And so any contract he entered into would have to, is that correct, Mike? Mm-hmm. So all I'm asking is let's put some more money in the line item for economic development. And what happens to that money, that's open for debate, and we can talk about that in a study session. And obviously, if we were going to enter a contract, it would require a second meeting, right, for us to make a vote on that. Yeah. So that's the reasoning behind putting more money into the line item, is with the potential that's out there to maybe attract some industry to some much-needed areas in the community. Having that money there is the first step, and then the second step would be if we decide later to enter into a contract, that money's already there, we don't have to try to worry about it.
Well, and that's kind of the way I look at it. I know that we do lots of other things. I mean, you know, we support other things in, you know, our community, and hope that, you know, we get some type of return on those, albeit where it's the, you know, Boys and Girls Club, it's the senior citizens, you know, and we think that's money well spent. And I think, you know, $11,000, that's, you know, economic development. I think, yes, that, you know, that's just to me, a small amount, you know, compared to the other things that we pay for. And I think, but I think it could have potential for great returns.
So I would say, you know, we I make a motion, we put the money in the line item, and then, you know, we can lean on the committee to come back to the, us as a council with a more firm recommendation as to what they decide once they've had a chance to meet as a bigger group. Is that legal? Yeah, I'm okay with that. Yeah, we adjourned the meeting now. I mean, you just can't.
I'll second that motion.
Which is, oh, Lee has something you want to say.
I just want to say a few words, y'all, at that meeting. I had some questions as well. You know, my biggest question was, sorry, about this, but that last page there was a lot of volume speak.
Right.
I recommend that you highly read that.
Yeah.
Because there's some clauses in there that basically, I've got a reference here for you. That 1.3, 1.1 adds 10% to the addition to the expenditures, just as a fee on that front page.
1.2, yeah.
Well, yeah. There's another, there's a clause there that they get 10% above that. We got to appropriate that money too. Then the contract also. Invoice first calendar month on effective date, and each month thereafter. It's open-ended. In my opinion, as long as it's legal.
Well, it seems
fee
like
could be going $5,000 a month.
It seems
and
like
I brought that up about y'all having enough money put in place.
So all we're going to do right this moment is put in $11,500 total, and then we're not making any decisions about what to do with it. And then we'll go into the study session, and we can hash it out and decide and talk in a little more detail.
Every city and town needs strong economy.
Yeah. So beefing up our budget, there's not a bad choice.
But also, just to say, too, that on the way I'm reading this, this is just for a, I mean, yeah, I guess it could go on, but, I mean, we'd be just committing for 2 months. Period. That's the cap.
But if you read that,
it's for 2 months and the excuses not to exceed above that amount. So that is the total. The total net period against the total. They described the 2% that's on the tax line. That's not asked. We've already addressed what we think the total cap amount might be.
So if we're moving the money that's in economic development, who's got the authority to spend it? The committee? The mayor? Well, I mean, once the council puts it in there, I mean, it's out of our hands. It can be spent.
In fact, we've looked something that's used part of any part of $11,500 or whoever might be in there. We would have to come back to council and
You got to look at the things. You got to look at the things he could spend it on. He could spend it on some kind of advertisement, but he's not going to be able to spend it on a contract. He's not going to be able to enter a contractual agreement without coming back to us.
He can spend a whole lot of money without having a contract.
Any of those dollars can't be spent by anybody on the committee. Plus, we have no mechanism for just taking the money.
Sure. So I still don't know, we're beefing up the economic development fund, but I don't know what we're beefing it up for.
In anticipation of projects to come.
We're beefing it up for something.
It's kind of like we need to have this study session. So we can say, all right, this is what we talked about earlier, this resolution. I mean, we're beating a dead horse because I'm like you, Rod. I mean, I don't know what we're putting it in there for. So, we could put money in there at any given time. I mean, that's the beauty of the resolution.
And I mean, I know the money's safe in the general fund, and I know it's probably safe in the economic development fund. I don't know what it's for in the economic development fund, and since I don't know what it's for, I'd just assume it's set in the general fund until if we got a need.
Go around it. I mean, the intent is that if you put it in there, it's going to be in there to get a contract.
That's.
Let's just keep that on the open. That's the whole reason.
No intent.
Whether we do the contract or not is what the discussion is about.
Right.
But the thing, y'all give me a good warm fuzzy feeling when y'all brought the UCA deal. We're all behind this. It's a great deal. Let's go for it. And that's easy. Let's do it. But y'all seem kind of all warm and fuzzy right here. And I just don't know.
Well, I think the difference there for me, the deliverable was a document that we had in hand that tells us what to do. The difference now is we're really making that next step into pursuing leads, which may or may not pan out. And again, that's part of the business. That's part of economic development. You can do a whole lot of work. I mean, each one of these projects that we talked about, you can call tomorrow and say, we're done. And how much time has the city spent, and the committee spent, department spent on each of these projects, and it's gone like that. And I will, you know, and just to reiterate that, the TCS is way over budget on their bids on the construction side. So I think the possibility of that happening could be out there. You know, they'll probably try to, I mean, I know we're going back negotiating, trying to get everything in budget to move forward, and I think they intend on to move forward, but we have no control over what the other people do. That's everything with economic development. People are looking at moving in the other building, we're dealing with different owners and different people. All those things could go off the table if something goes wrong.
The city has invested $250,000 to lay a water line with the hope that other businesses will come.
I absolutely 100% agree with that. That's probably the best economic development tool we have.
Okay, so what we're asking for here is put some money there in case we need to react to a service or a contract to bring in more business. Now, you know, we've been lucky so far. We've got a good lead on TSC. We've got a good lead on this other company that wants to come in to Greenwood. You know, the poultry supply. That was a case of me getting the people that want to come to Greenwood, to the people that own the building, and working out a suitable lease for both of them. You know, we've been lucky on that, but we've got to be able to move and be able to go after businesses. Once they say, boy, Greenwood's a pretty nice place, where you got calls. Well, we can sit here and phone call back and forth, or we can get serious with these people. Get something done and move faster.
Okay, to get serious and move faster, who's the chair of Economic Development
Committee?
Michael, how much do you think you need for the year 2015?
I think if we were comparing it to other cities of our size, we need 100,000.
So you're telling me if I call Hope, Clarksville, Batesville, Malvern, they're all operating on 100,000?
Some of them probably more.
But they've been operating for a while.
But they've been operating, yeah, that's the difference, but they've been operating.
They've been operating for a while. And I always try to agree with somebody that says, it's not just luck. It's not just luck that we're in the position that we are now, that people are dealing with. It's through Sonny and others working hard on the telephone to make those things happen. And myself and the mayor.
Well, there's the point.
You just
named three people that I've been sitting up here waiting to say my piece. He makes a lot of money. You get paid pretty well. He gets paid pretty well. That's y'all's job to promote this city. She is a mayor's assistant, does a lot of internet work and website, and I'm sure, and that's what these folks are paid to do. I don't have any, there's absolutely no way that I'm spending $11,500 more. I wouldn't spend one penny more. I'm already spending over $100,000 on guys that are supposed to be doing their job. They're getting paid well to promote this city. I promote this city every chance I get. And now, I don't know who the mystery gold mine is that's supposed to be coming in here, and I don't really care, and I hope they do come in. I don't want that opportunity to go away because we don't take this lady on under this contract. She's been helping volunteer, and I appreciate that. And I hope she would stay on and help. I don't know if you live in Greenwood, but I sure do, and I'd like to see jobs. That's like I mentioned earlier. The water line deal exactly is the greatest thing. But I see no reason to spend any more money when we're already paying guys. I mean, to be honest with you, Gary, I had trouble paying you money. You know what I'm saying? Because we have a mayor that's supposed to be going to Little Rock and getting money and checking all that stuff. We didn't at the time, you know, so, but I don't have any problem with that. Absolutely, and I'm so grateful for that. But I feel like we've got everybody else in place that's doing a good job, and I would hope that, I mean, it's just kind of like the water committee. That hurt me to death, telling Greg Cross and Tim Posey they couldn't do their job with hoops, so we had to hire a committee. And I still, it leaves a bad taste in my mouth, you know, and I tell those guys that every time I see them. So anyway, I feel like I have faith in my planning director to go out and find businesses. I don't know who the Chamber of Commerce president is, but I hope they're doing their due diligence, trying to help out as well. And that's something that the mayor needs to get on board with those guys. They need something, whoever the chamber president is, needs to be at those meetings that y'all are. I hope they're on the committee, I'm sure, you know.
Actually, he is on the committee.
Okay.
I failed to mention Don Jones.
Don Jones.
Yeah.
So, I mean, all due respect to this company here, but whenever I had to start squinting at the fine print, and we've been kind of looking through this too as she spoke. I mean, 3.2 talks about subcontracting people, and we got to pay them too. I mean, when y'all ain't even got to that yet, so I have faith in the guys at our department heads and our paid consultant and our mayor. I mean, I just have faith in those guys getting jobs here. And the committee that's been formed are doing a great job. So that's my 2 cents worth, whatever that's worth. So, I mean, I'm not hoping to sway votes or anything on this. Moving the money in the budget probably wouldn't hurt to do that, but I don't.
When you said something about putting more money in the debt, I'm about to ask that.
Well, I don't. I mean, I just have faith in you guys doing. I'd like to hope y'all do your jobs. I mean, that's in getting businesses here. If we're this close to a hot lead, then keep on working on that hot lead. And I mean, I don't see why I've got to have to pay another lady, or another firm, or whoever it might be to you know, seal the deal. I mean, I
was the person who found the company, and then they called me.
Gotcha. All right.
After it was a dead project for the
city,
I considered. So that's how
it helped me. Okay. So that's why I'm saying if we don't go ahead and enter into this contract, I can't imagine a phone call tomorrow saying don't go there. Those guys are a bunch of redneck idiots. I'd hope that wouldn't come. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I hope there's a little bit of integrity involved in this deal. But I just don't have any. I mean, I don't see spending that extra money. That's just my point of it. I mean.
I don't do economic development every day.
Mm-hmm.
Money doesn't do just economic development.
Right.
Other parts of the job. And so it's really looking for someone, whether it's Cheryl or a different company or whoever we hire an employee for a service, you're looking for someone who can perform that task because other people can't. I mean, everybody on the group is a volunteer for the committee, with the exception of the mayor and ones that are actually employed by the city. Everybody else on the committee is a volunteer at this point. So we're given time from our own jobs and to help promote the city and be here after hours and work on things. But I can't be on the phone at my job calling different people to pursue leads because I've got to draw stuff so you guys can build things and schools can build things. And I just can't do it all day long every day. So that's the benefit. When we do certain jobs, we hire consultants. Going to take a coast for the last month. get the building up to rentable conditions. Cheryl's been working with the owners of this company, along with Cole, and it's led to another lead that supports this one company, that's led to another. Now, so once it got past the real estate thing, I said, here, guys, take the ball and run, because you're over my head right now. And I think the rest of us on the committee do the same thing. We have, each one of us has expertise at it, but we know when, what our limitations are, and we can hand it off to Jeff, or Cole, or Gary. You know, if there's somebody that we've got an interest in, we throw the name out on the table, and Gary says, I know somebody that I can call, well, Gary might have called, or I make them call, whatever. So, you know, that's kind of how the committee's working right now. We kind of gel with each other, and so, you know, like I said, two folks in the back have taken this project and taken it from a, basically, like Cheryl said, a dead project, and turned it into a viable project, but I think we're going to see it happen.
Council, if I could just put my two cents in.
Yes, sir.
I've been on the committee since, I guess, close to the beginning, and you know, it's taken a long time. And then I got excited. You know, I'm seeing that some things happen within the committee, and people making phone calls, people going out to the sites. I work on leads every day, and very few of them come true. You know, but this, you know, I can see a pretty hot lead here, and it's over my head, and it's over a lot of my heads. And that's why we're kind of recommending, hey, let's take the next step. Let's get professional. Pursue this lead because I've seen some pretty big projects go down because the expertise was not there in the military. I think we've got expertise here, most likely, and that's why I kind of got excited about, hey, let's see what the council says. But I'm pretty much to the point where I'm seeing this next step, and I'm not sure exactly how to do it, but I see some professionals that possibly can do it and pursue this type of lead, and I think that's what we're trying to go. But that's my two cents.
I'm going to say where I'm at on this. I'm for moving some more money into the economic development because I want to support y'all. I want to, that most likely, I want when y'all come back with your, because I'm not, the consultant deal I'm not sure of right now. I'm uneasy with this consultant deal, and when I'm sitting here looking at the contract, y'all need to turn that most likely into this is the deal. This is where we need to go when y'all come back. So, but I'm for moving money that it's available for y'all to use. Yes, Michael?
I'm just going to say on the comment you just made, I don't think we can do that. I can't set up here when I open those envelopes and tell you what the number's going to be. I have no control. The same thing's going to happen with the lease. We could have the hottest lead in the world, and they might decide tomorrow they want to go to the marketplace.
Okay, so y'all's recommendation is we pass this deal right tonight, and we hire the consultant. That's your recommendation?
I'm not sure of that.
Then go back, and then come back and give us a more assured, you know, this is who we want to go with. You know, this is what we want to do. Because it doesn't, I'm not getting that from you.
I don't think that the question of hiring a consultant is as much as, you know, the things that we talked about on contract and all that. That is the kind of stepping out of the committee. Is just a good contract for the city. Is a consultant that is familiar with the process and all that good for the city? Yes.
Okay. Well, but I'm for moving.
Contract that we're looking at, you know, perfect. I don't think so.
The study sessions talk about that portion of it, and we were hoping to pass the resolution to move the money. Close the meeting, and then we go into study session. We talk in the weeds about
it. I think the money transferred over there with the idea that it's going to be able for us to fund a consultant. I think that's kind of where I am now. Getting the five-year contract worked out, that's for a study session.
Okay. We can move that money at any time. I mean, if you come back and say, this is what we're wanting to do, this is how we're wanting to do it, and we've got this comfortable lead and we want to move forward,
we need some help. We can move the money at any time. It's not that we have to, I mean, it's like Rod said, the accountability part of it. I mean, you guys from the committee is, what I keep hearing is, I mean, you guys are wanting to move forward this. I'm wanting to move forward. I want to make Greenwood a better place. But nobody's 100% sure that it's the right avenue to take. And like Michael says, you don't ever know what it's going to do. Granted, it's a gamble. But once y'all get to that point, y'all start getting more comfortable as a committee and feel more comfortable about the projects and those leads that come in, there's nothing that says that y'all's chairperson of that, which is Michael, can come up here and say, hey, we're going to need some funding in order to, you know, we've got some projects that look like are going to be productive for us. We're going to have some money. But we can do that at any given time. I mean, whether it's tonight, whether it's next meeting, or whenever it is, to make the benefit of the fact, like Rod's talking about, of the surety of, well, what we're doing. I'm not messed up by spending the money to make Greenwood grow. That's not the issue. It's just like we don't know what we're doing with it. It's kind of like that old blank check factor.
Well, I think it's the timing is the issue.
Right. I mean, it's not that we don't want to do it.
Started with their contract with someone else. The thing with the council is, you know.
But you're still going to have to come back in order to spend it.
If it's not a special.
So, I mean, it's a catch-22 case.
Or a,
I mean, if we put $100,000 in there tonight, you're still going to have to come back to us to spend it. So it's the same principle. I mean, you're not gaining anything by being in there tonight in order to approve this Utah contract. I mean, you're going to have to come back regardless. I mean, no matter what we do. So, I know we got a motion and a second on the floor. So,
I'm up for making more money available to you, but I am. I know when I put money in parks, I'm getting a return. I get a value. I'm getting a quality of life return for that money. I'm gonna be looking for the return in the long haul with y'all. I don't mind if things are happening. I don't mind. Maybe we should be where Clarksville is. Maybe we should have $100,000 in there.
Don't have an interstate. Or a college or a casino.
Or Batesville. They don't have an interstate.
I think that's why we
racetrack.
Well, we're not approving the expenditure.
True. But I know that in my mind, the best economic development tool is sewer and water. A guy buys that piece of property and you say, where's my sewer and water? It's right there on the edge of your property. You can tie onto it. You know, the tap's a little expensive, but it's right there. You can get started immediately. And you're in that world every day, Michael. That's the best economic development tool. That's the best thing we can do to get things moving.
Well,
and then the other...
asked me three questions. When we were looking at property, we're going to bring the city limits. We have water and sewer. And they originally looked at Highway 10, 71, well, there's no water, no sewer, you know, so they said, well, that's out. So they moved over to, you know, what about this across the street from Walmart? You know, well, there's no water or sewer over there, it's in the city limits. Well, where else? And so I started showing them property. He was on Google in Arizona, I was on Google here. We started at Liberty Drive, and we worked each one of those parts as the fence. He says, is there water? I said, we can get water. Is there sewer? Yes, we did sewer. Is it in the city limits? Yes. He says, I'll send my engineer down there tomorrow to look at the property. Here's how it's done.
You know, once you get past that hassle of can I build something here and can I get it done, then I think it turns into quality of life. You know,
exactly.
The trail runs right by here and there's some green space back there and there's a neighborhood park within a quarter of a mile. I think quality of life then enters in, and that's an economic
that's what you see
tool.
In West Arkansas, what you see in Little
Rock. So, you know, if we give, I can build some trail for $10,000. The scouts will go erect a pavilion, cross a creek with a bridge, and Michael will go out and build a bike trail, and I feel I can see that return on my money, and I think that helps the whole community.
There's nothing, go ahead, Lee.
All these cities you talk about have seen growth. One thing you see a common denominator is a shovel ready industrial site. Podo, Clarksville, Conway, they've got sites ready. So if you want to see a return on your money, go get your industrial site ready to go.
Well, we've had that, and we kind of made a big mess out of it. I'm talking, and it's not us on the council, but we, the governing body of Greenwood, we had an industrial park, and we made a huge mess out of it, and it just kind of got good old boyed and kind of...
I think you're making your own point. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I think that's the point. We can keep building stuff, and we will. And by the way, I want to make sure that all the councilmen rest assured that this mayor and this administration, these employees, these Economic Development Committee members will continue to do all they can possibly do. I mean, that's a promise every single day. I mean, no, I'm not calling... I'm not making 25 phone calls a day to people to bring them here, because there's a few other things to be addressed by the mayor. And I really don't mean to sound sarcastic, but I'm working real hard, and Brooke is, and I know Sonny is. I mean, he's back there, and some of these things have been initiated by him, and you can build things. I think the biggest issue that we have, one, is this contract. There's no doubt about it. It's an unusual contract. It's an out-of-state contract. And by the way, the whole committee did not get to meet on this, and it wasn't because we left people out. They just didn't make it to the meeting. So we will keep addressing this every time.
Well,
your point, I'm sorry, just a second, because I'll lose it. I may already have. I think Rod's point is you're building these things, but you can build all you want to, but unless you have somebody going and get, it's the squeaky wheel. I mean, I don't know much about it, but I do know that the young man in the pink shirt, by the way, not everybody can pull it off. Good job, Cole. That young man has been working constantly. I think he could stand if he wants to. He doesn't have to, but he could tell you that the hours that, and everybody has. I am singling him out, but he has worked on a deal that almost seems like it's going to happen, but yet it's every day that he keeps working at it, because you could stop for one day and it could go away. It's been brought up a couple of different ways. So the growing pains of hiring someone, a professional, again, like has been said, whether it's Cheryl or whoever it is, we did the same thing. I did it as a parks director, and this council did it hiring Michael Lejeune as an architect. I mean, we still kind of go, wow, I wish we could do that by ourselves. I would have hated to have been the contract general manager on that pavilion in Bell Park. You wouldn't have it. It would be a tent or something. So until, I'm not trying to preach to you so much, but I think it's important that we all understand that it takes a certain a professional, whether it's Cheryl or whoever it is, to do that. Police department would not be what it is. I mean, the new building would not be without Michael. The promenade, we had some growing pains back. Remember when we hired Bob Callens out of Little Rock? We're like, wow, really? We got to pay a guy out of Little Rock to come in here and tell us how to build a fancy sidewalk with arbors on it? Well, we did, and look what we got. I mean, you kind of get what you pay for. Now, you don't always get what you pay for, and sometimes you don't get it right away. Brooke said 15 years. Who knows? This particular lead may go away, and we may have spent, and I'll just say it, we may have spent $11,500 and get nothing. Absolutely nothing.
Rod, you're talking about, we tried this with the industrial park company, incredible. But everybody that I have talked to, our key to success is the Highway 71, Pinsburg, Highway 10, down 10. That was kind of blown out of the water. We're going to have to readdress that. But that's where these people are wanting. They're wanting on this side of Greenwood. And if they're a retail operation, they want to be in that corner of Pinsburg and 71, because that's where we're going to have water and sewer, on both sides, on those four corners. And that's what we kind of targeted those four corners there for immediate growth. But we're going to have to look at the other side of 71. We're going to have to look at Highway 10 and to the west of 10, one of the days. The industrial park out here is nice, and it is, like you say, it's shovel ready. That's going to take somebody that doesn't do a lot of shipping with semis, because I've had people call me and ask about the property on the other side of Alpha Packaging. They want to know how close we are to an interstate, how close are we to a railroad, how close are we to a water source. So Well, that side of town is not very close. You get on one of 71 Pittsburgh, about, you know, you're 10 minutes from a Kennerston. You're, you know, about that to a railroad, and that's not that much further to a Bristol. So that's the big selling point of the west side of Greenwood, supposedly.
You know what? I guess it's been about 12 years ago. We had the guy come down from University of Arkansas, and I subscribed to his philosophy, and he was an economic guy, and he said, look, he said, y'all don't go out and blow a lot of money trying to attract industry to your town, because you'll never get it compared to Fort Smith. He said, y'all go out and build parks, you go out and build trails, you go out and build bikeways. He said, those people that work up there will want to come live down here. He said, your strongest asset in the community is that school. And he said, you need to build around that school. You need to build sidewalks to that school, trails to that school, you know, build, you know, where there's nice residential around that school. He said, don't waste a bunch of money. He said, you'll never have the railroad, you'll never have the river, you'll never have the interstate. Fort Smith's got it all. And I think he was a pretty bright guy.
But what he's talking about is heavy industry. We're not looking at heavy industry. We're looking at retail, restaurants, things that we now drive to Fort Smith for, that we can get here in Greenwood. Of course, my big dream is to have something in Greenwood people from Fort Smith drive down here for. Don't know what that is yet. But we're not out there looking for a type of city. We're not looking at a paper warehouse or something like that we want smaller industry that we're looking at, 25, 30, 50 employees, no more than that, that people want. And that's one reason why this company that we're talking about that's looking at that building out there is one to come to Greenwood, because of the park, the trail, the green space, and about half their employees already live here.
So I've got a motion on the floor at the second. If you could vote on that, maybe we can move forward with the study session a little bit.
We do have a motion and a second on the floor.
What else is there to talk about in the study session?
Well, I might have a few comments that I'd rather have directed during the study session.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
No.
Lance Terry?
Yes.
Motion carries.
I make a motion to adjourn and start a study session.
Second.
We have a motion second to adjourn.
So I guess
if you need to go to the restroom, there it is. Kenny Sunday, would you like to do your report real quick?
No, on board?
I'm kidding, but
I apologize. I'm stoked.
That's okay. That's all right. We talked about you.
I just feel like
we're just going to have a study session.
It's more of an informal way for us to discuss a few things. And I just had
I don't get three.
Because I didn't get to come to the committee meeting today.